Republicans now say they're going to oppose their own health care bill after the Congressional Budget Office says that bill would cause 22 million Americans to lose their health insurance. GOP leaders say that if they work on the bill a little more, they can double that number. It's Tuesday, 3 a.m., June 27th, 2017. I'm David Feldman. We have a lot of show. Let's get right to it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, and go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Amazon banner, and do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. On today's show, Emmy Award-winning writer and actor Rick Overton. He's one of the stars of the new Jim Carrey series on Showtime, I'm Dying Up Here. From Jay Leno's Tonight Show, from Jimmy Fallon's Tonight Show, from all your favorite late-night shows, one of the best comedians out there, my good friend Mark Pitta joins us. Also, a Writers Guild Award-winning comedy writer from Saturday Night Live, Dave Sirus. And our old friend, comedian Liam McEneaney. Stay with me. Enjoying today's show, please remember to do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the Amazon banner, click on it, and then shop away. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. I promise you, every penny we get goes towards keeping the show going. And if you're doing your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website, hit the contact button. Let me know so I can thank you. Joining us from Hollywood, Rick Overton, Emmy Award-winning writer, and he's in the new series on Showtime every Sunday night, I'm Dying Up Here. Hello there, Rick Overton.
Hey, David. Thanks for having me on, man.
Thank you for doing this. First up, we have to talk about I'm Dying Up Here. This is a series that Jim Carrey's producing, and it's about the early years of the modern-day stand-up comedy explosion.
1973, the Sunset Strip. It's a fictitious comedy club called Goldie's. It's not the Comedy Store, but it's like the Comedy Store. It's not the Improv, but it's nearby. And we have things that are like those different clubs. Comedians that they're using on the show, some of whom were around for the original scene, are playing roles not as comedians all the time, but as other roles in the show that are wonderful. And it takes a great look at how the comedy business started.
When you say it takes a good look or a great look at how the comedy business started, why 1970?
The boom
started in 73. Is that what you're saying?
It's before the boom. It's showing how it built to the boom. It's pre-boom. 73 isn't the boom.
When is the boom?
It's not time yet. I'd say later 70s, late 70s. It's when the explosion of other clubs opened.
Without giving too much away here, and I did read that book and I loved it. It's based on that book, right?
Yeah. No, loosely based on the book, but it's really more about the comedy scene in general. It's about the entire, the way vinyl was for mm-hmm. the record industry. This is for the comedy industry, and on the other side, but the exact same time frame. And I would say, if there was a distinction between vinyl and between I'm Dying Up Here, it's that you didn't. As much as I wanted to care about all those people on vinyl, I couldn't attach to their crisis.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the people in I'm Dying Up Here are very relatable and sympathetic. And I think that's a big part of it, you know.
The boom started in the late 70s. I've got a little something in my throat. I've got Rick Overton on. And I can't make the joke that I want to make because I have too much respect for you, Rick Overton. So I'm going to move on. But you know, and my audience knows, that it's semen. But I'm not going to do a joke about having semen in my throat because I want to impress you. We're going highbrow on my show.
Highbrow here.
So I have to apologize to my listeners for one quick second and brag to Rick Overton and tell him that in the past 3 weeks, Congressman Alan Grayson has done this show twice.
Yes. I love Alan.
Before we get back to I'm Dying Up Here, explain to our listeners why it is such a major coup to have Alan Grayson on the show.
You might remember a very famous piece of business on the floor of Congress where, you know, this is even before Bernie was speaking out as boldly. Alan kind of was the first guy to just completely not just rock the boat, but capsize it. So and then they had to right it again with ropes and other boats and stuff. He knocked it completely sideways when he came on and said, "Here's the Republican health care plan. If you get sick, hurry up and die." And there was all the proper people were outraged.
Mm-hmm.
And all the ones you would want to be outraged were outraged.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was very impressed with all of that. And I went on to get to know him and help him with his campaign and stuff. And, you can tell when someone's really shaking up the boat is suddenly there's all these weird, out of nowhere, only just found out now controversies about the person. How convenient that you only just found out now.
What do you mean?
You know, that kind of crap.
What do you mean?
Well, they're always finding things about Bernie. Now, suddenly there's something about Bernie now that he's so popular. Oh, suddenly it's a problem of property, even though lots of people do it. Suddenly there's an investigation. And, they're trying to do things to Alan Grayson, saying about his, he was abusing his wife when I am a personal friend, and I happen to know what the truth is, that it was quite the contrary.
And there's videotapes.
And there was video.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm the one that told him to tape. Said, bring a video. Video tells the truth.
I did two interviews with him, and then we talked after the show. And he brought up the stuff with the ex-wife, and I didn't even know about it. I knew that there was something, but I never clicked on it because I wasn't interested.
Right. And most Americans aren't. And it's as a smear tactic, it's been a catastrophic and abject failure.
I'll tell you why character does matter. And then I want to get back to Alan Grayson and 1973 and the comedy boom. And I want to impress Rick Overton, because if you don't like me, I'm in trouble. And by the way, I was explaining that to my shrink and he didn't understand that. There are certain people in other people's lives who you have to live up to their expectations. And if you fail them, you fail yourself. And you're one of those people who,
No pressure there.
If you're one of those,
I'm very honored, though. I'm very flattered that you would think that your joke, if you got me to laugh, would be a big deal, because your jokes always do.
Well, it's not only the jokes, it's how I live my life. I have to live my life. I can't have you not approve of the way I live my life. And I've been told that's the wrong way to live, but Rick Overton.
I, 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 seems like, I don't know that much about it, but it seems like you're having a good time back there in New York and liking your world. And do you like your world back in New York right now, Dave?
Well, given that we both went to Dwight Morrow High School.
That's right. You can actually go visit every now and then, inexpensively.
There are moments, and you don't get these in Los Angeles, where I'm driving through New Jersey to visit my sister or my mother, and there's cut grass, and I get high school wood. I look down, I'm in my car, and I'm going, wait a second, how is the smell of cut grass giving me high school boner?
You have a memory boner, a nostalgia boner.
What is that about?
Look down, and it's about back when we could get boners.
Listen, honey, stay right here. I can't afford the Viagra. Pasquale's going to come in with a leaf blower.
Yeah, I just need you to lean up against these wooden arrows on the lawn of Dwight Morrow High School, because it's the first place I got laid, and now it's the only place I can get laid. It only happens here.
Yes, there was something about the grass at Dwight Morrow. Is that where you did? I know there were these arrows that everybody kept trying.
No, I'm. It's a fiction joke to use a landmark to help lock it down for others. That's not where it happened, but it's just for the joke.
What about rewriting the past, and not rewriting as in writing, but write, make it right. That Gatsby-esque need to go back in time and make something right. Do you have that urge?
I just tell the story, you know. I mean, go back in time and fix what you did.
Fix what you did, or
reword it to everyone else.
But go back and see that person, or whatever.
Well, go back and someone you had a conflict with, and see if now with your
Uzi.
Yeah, your Uzi.
I was talking about my penis, actually.
Oh, it's Uzi.
There's two things. Oh, well, actually, yeah, well, it oozes.
Oh, man.
It oozes, too.
Oh, God.
Yes, there are people I want to go back.
How did I forget who I was talking to for a second? My penis is oozy. I'm on the phone with David. Yay! I'm back.
But 1973 is when stand-up, the boom, the seeds were planted.
Still, you had to go through basically the Tonight Show. You had to go through that. And then what? That would not be forever. And not that much longer. Would the title be held as the only gate through which to go to success was the Carson Show. Because a Merv wouldn't do it.
Would a Carson do it, or is that a myth?
Back then, Freddie Prinze happened. Not every comic got one, but it doesn't have to be everyone. If suddenly two or three get them, then it's a rule. And it's, you know, or it's the potential for a rule.
Before Carson, it was the Ed Sullivan Show. Comics wanted to get on the Ed Sullivan Show, and they would go from playing clubs to playing nicer clubs. Then it was Carson, but there were a lot of guys, like Steve Martin did Carson for many years. Then Carson didn't like him anymore. He fell out of favor with Carson. He was only doing it with guest hosts. And then he came.
Oh, well, yeah, I have my own story of that history.
Please.
I'm Joan's last comic on her last show.
With Johnny.
Yeah. For the night of the blow-up. When they said, why are you going off to another network and cutting one half hour into my base and building your base off of my show?
What was the tension like when you did that?
There was an okay set, but then I found out it was the night that they said, you're never going to be back on this show again.
To Joan.
Yeah. And I was her comic she fought for.
Oh, so there was guilt by association.
Right.
Oy.
So now I'm playing the guy who picks the comics. You know, that's the cosmic joke of it.
McCauley.
to Cordova, Macaulay, it's LaSalle, it's like a few people at once. It's like an amalgam, because we live in a fictitious world where Goldie's is in place of the store, yet there is a store, and yet there is an improv, and there's all these clubs, plus the other clubs that we may name. So we just say the universe slightly larger.
Mm-hmm. So you're playing the guy who picks the comics.
Yeah, and his name in this universe is Mitch Bombardier.
Is that his real name?
Yes, that's his real name.
Bombardier. Wow. Yeah. Mitch Bombardier. That's so funny, because a bombardier is the guy who drops the bombs on the cities, right?
Destroys.
He destroys, right.
Destroys things.
They used to go over the Tonight Show sets with a fine-tooth comb. Was that to protect the comedian or to protect the guy who was putting the comedian on? How much of Macaulay and LaSalle and DeCordova, how much of their input was more about protecting their ass than the comic?
Well, I'd say a win-win was the only true protection.
Where the audience...
Great comic. Yeah, the audience liked it. Johnny liked it. You know, the comic wanted to come back. That's win-win-win. And that's generally the objective, so that your tenuous hanging by a sinew existence isn't threatened by having made a mistake somewhere that you don't think is a big one now, but that comes to get you later.
And if you're a comic and you're young, you do want somebody who understands that specific audience to guide you and tell you what the parameters are.
Right.
Too much freedom is a scary thing if you're young.
Well, and you can take that too far in the other direction. You can crush art. You can snuff it out like a match hit.
I don't know if you want to go in this direction, so you don't have to answer this question. There are some people who felt that Johnny Carson unnecessarily censored his comics because he wanted to be the political guy. He also unnecessarily censored female comics, that while he helped Roseanne and a few female comics, for the most part, there, and you don't have to address this, but he helped Joan Rivers, but a lot of female comics thought he didn't.
Right. I'd heard that.
Support them enough.
Right.
It's a good thing we don't have any female comics here who can talk about that, so we can.
Well, I mean, I have over the years heard that complaint. And certainly my own dynamic is that I'm, you know, I have my own story that could certainly see that there is politics involved. Even though I don't have the same exact dynamic, why? There are politics involved. It isn't just purely for its own sake.
Well, you're talking about the politics of Joan Rivers and Fox, Barry Diller, and disloyalty to Johnny, and you're being associated with that. That's politics. What about the what about the politics of going after the president, going after a specific party? They really don't want on the Tonight Show.
No, they don't want to lose a demographic. It's, you know, for us, the comedian, you're only talking about losing 12 to 20 people.
Mm-hmm.
But to Johnny, that would be losing how many millions when there weren't other things? It was in the millions. The Nielsens were in the millions back then. You lost 700,000 of this or whatever. And it was all that there was. You go click, click, click five times and you're done watching TV.
Was it different back then? We're told that this country has never been as polarized as it is now.
How many times have you heard that phrase?
Since the Civil War.
Yeah. And it's always never been as much as. Every single time, because otherwise you can't sell your publication. You know? No one wants the, well, it's not as bad as headline.
Right, right. So in the 70s and the 80s, you were alienating audiences if you were a liberal making fun of conservatives. If I'm a conservative and I see a comedian on the Carson show making fun of Reagan and Bush, do I say, that's it, I'm never watching Johnny Carson again? Or are you adult enough to say, well, it's a big world, and if that happens to be a liberal comic who's making fun of my belief system, I'll have to wait an extra 3 minutes for him to be off, and then I'll continue watching. How much of that is true when they say a political satirist is going to lose millions of viewers for us?
Well, I think now there's a sensitivity that wasn't there before. I think now it's a minefield in a way that is relatively, in the last few years, new. The behavior of a true attack on, but I don't think it'll last forever. I think we're living through a storm, and you hunker in for the storm, and you'll see some important shit in your life fly by. It'll uproot some things you thought wouldn't be uprooted. But if we're still here at the end of it, we're improvisers. We'll just go yes and make what's next. Mm-hmm. Like we always do. That's what America is. It's an improv.
Is the divisiveness good? There was a time when if you brought your girlfriend home or your boyfriend and he wasn't your religion, the parents would disapprove. Now, more people are willing to accept their child marrying out of the religion than they are their child marrying out of the party. And I think that's a good thing. I think that's healthy because the party that you're affiliated with truly reveals who you are as opposed to the religion. If you're a Democrat, I kind of know who you are. I know your tribe. And if you're a Republican, I kind of know that you're a sexual deviant and a racist and a liar and a cheat and a scoundrel and a scamp. And you're not going to be good to my daughter. As opposed to finding out that she's marrying a Jew or a Muslim or a Roman Catholic, that doesn't tell me anything. But if you tell me my daughter's marrying a Republican, I'd say, be careful with the sex. It's going to get dangerous. Right?
Well, I'm at a point where I'm not really looking at those sides anymore because the Democrats have not been terrific this round, and I'm open to a third party. And I'm not going to lionize one side completely. I'd say they've blown it monstrously. They've blown it, and they've acted horrifically while covering how they've blown it. But trying, if any more fingers get pointed, we're all going to have to wear OSHA approved eyewear to protect ourselves from losing our eyesight. You know, look, once you blame one thing for your loss, I go, okay, maybe that's true. Oh, you're blaming 7, 8 things for your loss. No, it's you, motherfucker, you lying motherfucker, you deflecting lying motherfucker. The reason you're the motherfucker is you're dressed like us. You're not the opposition. You're pretending to be us, and you're a spy. Hang yourself. And that's what they've done. They've hung themselves. They've hung themselves by trying to school us and scold us and shame us for wanting Bernie. They did say fuck them. You don't have to say fuck them. They fucked themselves. It's sit back and watch. They pulled the wrong stick out of the Jenga game, and it came down on them. That's why every catastrophic failure just stacks upon the next for them now. They can't hold on to the ball for 1 second without dropping it. And you get no apology out of me for that. They fucked this up, and I accept zero blame for that. We go no further in this conversation if that's how it continues.
I remember when the Occupy Wall Street movement started.
That's right.
You wore a jacket right. Till it actually became part of your skin that said 99%.
That's correct, sir. That's right. And to be bossed around and told that we'd better go back and be a Democrat. Now you better listen to us. No, there are more of us. You listen to us. It's the other way around. There are more of us. We outnumber you. You take our suggestions now. For fuck's sake, I'm so fed up with the false accusation blaming that we led to this catastrophe of Trump. The CNN set him up. He's friends with the opposition. They have dinner together. There's no photos of Bernie hanging out with Trump all over the fucking place with his wedding and golf course. There's none of that. He was the only one that would have gotten us out of this. And everything else about that is a corporate-funded lie. Zero apology for having said so.
Is somebody cutting grass? Because I have a massive erection.
All right, man, I can hear it. That's how loud your boner is. I can hear it on the phone. It's causing interference on the line. It's like an antenna. They're going to dock the Hindenburg to it in Jersey, and then it's going to blow up.
Yeah, I agree with everything. This is music to me. Both of us are pragmatic, but we're not incrementalists. Okay, I'll vote for Hillary because she's better than Trump, but she better...
They're better than theory. Yeah, less than, not as, at least, doesn't work anymore. Not when the environment has given us 10 years and Stephen Hawking, who knows more than any motherfucker, says we have 100 years of all life on Earth left.
Right.
So all these little inconsequential, little nitpicky fucking things, fuck all of them. They can go to the tar pit, start being something useful like fuel, you know, become tar. Hurry up and be extinct then, because you're killing the rest of us. If it isn't about the environment first, and that's all that really matters, then every one of them is just some distraction, some pointless money-grabbing distraction. It's all that really matters. The water supply, the air supply, the food supply.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone that stands for it, stay with. Anyone that hurts it, get away from.
Anybody who thinks that the other side, that the Republicans are incrementalists, take a look at what they're doing. Take a look at what they're doing right now. They are going for everything.
They have to. They're out of time.
Well, so are we. Our side, though, it's always, let's do things incrementally. Let's take our time. We don't want to ruffle any feathers. It's got to be total war. That's what the Democrats completely missed the boat on. It's total war. The Republicans are fighting total war.
They're working with them. They're the weak, fake opponent. It's that prize fighter. You go down in round three. Make it look good, but you go down a trail, or we'll find you and we'll fucking kill you.
Right.
We got you. We got the footage on you. You got to do what we say.
Well, it's got to change.
It's a mob deal. Yeah.
Naomi, it is a mob deal. It's a bust out. It's exactly what it is. Yeah. It's a bust out. They're busting at the government. They look at our health care and they say 1/6 of the economy is making people live. How do we bust this out like the mafia does and get our cut of 1/6 of the economy? It's not about saving lives. It's about It's about the health insurers. The thing that really is upsetting, that Medicare for all is not on the table. This is just this slow march to oblivion. This is what our system.
Now maybe down the line we can look at a third party once we completely establish the Democrats back in place. We can think about that. I got a lot of those posts rather on social media from total fucking strangers who think I can't figure out when you look at their page and their posts go immediately to 2013 that they're a shill. Everything's a photo of them with their head turned around or a dog. Fucking insult. You amateurs.
One part of me says our slaveholding, misogynistic, white male founding fathers were geniuses. And they gave us this constitution that allows us to have these mini revolutions without killing each other, except for the Civil War and some political assassinations. So if we cling to the Constitution, which I'm not so sure, I'm not so sure the Constitution can deal with climate change, with the internet, with separate facts. But let's say we stick to the Constitution. Gerrymandering notwithstanding, how much blame do the American people have? How much blame can we direct at the 99%? And again, I know
none, zero. New topic.
Wow.
That is the biggest motherfucking lie of all. That is the same. It's always putting it on the people. It's a deflection. It's a lie. And it's the wrong button, brother.
Okay. I'll change the topic, but do you mind if I...
That's right.
I do.
I say I'm all with it. Let's change it up right now. Let's do that.
Okay.
I am so angry at that accusation. So false. so off the mark, because it won't, they, anyone that defends that completely leaves out, and I guarantee you that's the case every single time, that everyone who says that says, oh, there was no tampering of the primary voting system. All of the magical tampering showed up just for the president part, not the midterm part.
Right.
And so it's completely the millennials' fault. It's completely the 99%'s fault. Another one of those false accusatory gouging out of nowhere fingers from the furball spinning around trying to save itself.
So it'd be like saying, slavery, why didn't the black people rise up and end slavery? Why do we have to fight a civil war? If slavery is so bad, why don't the blacks bring an end to it in the South? Why do we have to have a civil war to end it? That's basically what you're saying. There are some people.
What? Huh? What is about the blacks? What?
Well, you're not.
What about blacks in the South? No, this is not about. They didn't have any advantage. They didn't have any firearms.
No, I'm saying.
Completely Second Amendment armed peoples. No way to do it.
No, I'm saying. No.
No way to fucking do it.
No, I'm saying blaming the 99%.
Oh, yeah. It's exactly this. When I speak loudly, I'm not shouting at you. I'm shouting at it. I'm shouting at the fact that you're pointing out a thing that you also agree is fucking bullshit, right?
To blame the victim. That is our culture.
We agree. I'm agreeing with you.
Yeah.
That's fucking bullshit, man. I'm just passionate about this now.
Yeah.
I'm passionate that is, like, we are being lied to and about. And boy, don't zoom me, motherfucker. I know when I'm being zoomed. Don't play me. I'll turn it back. I'll destroy the trick so you can't use it again. I'll break your toy.
Right.
I'll make it. You use the toy on me, you'll never get it back.
It is a culture. I'm changing the topic. It is a It is a culture that has been trained to accept the lie and then lie to ourselves about whatever condition we're in. What was I wearing? It's the what was I wearing. Not just rape. It's you get your credit card bill and it's, what was I wearing? Well, I shouldn't have bought.
Exactly.
I should have gone to Old Navy instead of the Gap. It's my fault that I paid an extra $5 for these pants.
Right.
It's always your fault under the rubric.
Always your fault.
Yeah. You have choice and you have freedom.
The same thing as, sir, what did you do wrong with your VCR, sir? I'm on the phone. What's wrong with your computer, sir? What did you hit wrong, sir?
Mm-hmm.
No, I didn't do anything wrong. I'm doing everything you said. Well, obviously you did something wrong because I gave you all the right advice, sir.
Mm-hmm.
It's them protecting the fact that they're supposed to be the ones who are right and they don't have all the answers, not even remotely. Everyone's looking like the authority and no one knows what the fuck is next. And the whole job, you lose your job if you don't act like you look like what's next. You can't keep your office going with a shrug. Who knows? It's the who knows office. You don't hear about that, you know? No one wants to pay for that. They want to pay for answers, and no one has them now, so they're all faking it. And so accusation's one of the first go-to moves. Blame something else, because then it at least it takes them that much longer to get back to you.
Let's get back to comedy, and I'm dying up here.
Yeah, let's do it.
Do you think comedians, more than anybody else in America, learned quicker about corporate fraud?
I think.
Do you think we learn early?
Doing corporate dates. That helps.
That helps? Yeah.
That'll send the message home.
About waste, right? I mean, you do your corporate gig and you
You have them look through your act, have them fine tooth comb an act for you. Ever have them nitpick through your act?
Yes.
It's pretty rough, man.
And what do you learn about corporate waste being a corporate comedian when you go do a set?
They pay in excess of actual value. I'm just speaking for myself. But they pay more if you just say everything they want to hear.
Right.
And the money goes up the more you just simply agree with them.
Right. So you're in your 20s and you got 20 clean.
That's right.
You got 20 clean minutes. I'm speaking to how smart comedians are just through experience.
Right.
You're in your 20s. You get a necktie. You get booked for a corporate gig and you believe at the time, before you do your corporate gig, that government is inefficient, but corporations don't waste money. And then you get this check to do this corporate event that's at the Plaza Hotel, and they're serving shrimp and lobster, and Rod Stewart is coming on in an hour. This must cost a couple million dollars.
Once you get everybody fed.
Who is benefiting from this? Because this is a computer company. I don't think the people in this room are going to buy computers. If the stockholders knew about this, this seems right. like fraud and inefficiency. So you learned that in your 20s. You learned, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And you you learn to see how the sort of pecking order humans, like, because the comics are kind of a don't tell me what to do bunch, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can say that, Seth. And then you see humans who are completely in the pecking order of things, acting like they're strata and no further. Just looking at how other people, how their brains work to get, to gain success. Like, we sort of are, it's our fierce independence at first is the thing that we mark all our comedy territory with. And then later, as time goes on, or you start doing corporate dates, it's the acquiescence to external instructions.
And what did we learn early on? And this is because I'm getting to a larger point, and I think you're already there. But I've been fighting this for years about how important comedians are. Alex Brazell produces this show, and he's in his late 20s, and he insists that Rick Overton, for example, is a guru, that all knowledge can come from comedians. That's all you have to do is listen to comedians. And I keep saying, what the F are you talking about? But the longer I stay in this game, especially the podcasting, and talk to comedians, the more I realize they're the last honest intellectual out there. So, Mike, what you learned in your 20s about the necktie, and I don't mean David Carradine or the guy from NXS. That's a whole other story. But you learned the power of a necktie, the power of a suit. I remember being told,
even a suit with the sleeves pushed up and the necktie pulled down and skinny and leather like the knack. Remember when we wore those with the pushed up sleeves?
Yeah. And so you and I fought this. We said it only matters what I say and how I say it in front of an audience. Mm-hmm. And somebody explained, no. You have to pick a side, get a uniform. The audience will only listen to you if the uniform matches what you're saying and how you're saying it.
That so was born Feldo the Clown.
This is, I'm not, let's
the see. Ultimate rebellion to a principle.
So we saw through the suit. We're in our 20s, and all of a sudden, we're being told what we wear is just as important as what we think and how we say it. So when we when we meet our girlfriend's boss and he's wearing a suit, we go, what are you hiding?
Right.
Right?
Like that. Yeah. that's what I get from Pence. I get... Oh, that you look like a Ken doll, G.I. Joe doll kind of thing. There's some shit in your basement. There's some freaky shit going on. That's covering something. That's, look how normal I am, America. I'm hiding something huge because this is way too trying to look normal.
The only thing I can control is my whiskers, my ear hair, my toenails, and my fingernails, and how sharply pressed my suit is. The rest I can't control because little boys are swimming in my head. But
Oh, right, right. Liar, liar, Pence on fire.
The more well-groomed you are, the more you're trying to control something that you cannot control, right?
Look, I get if you, some fella does the ocean liners or whatever, and they want to tidy up a look to make a certain thing happen or do a TED talk or whatever, you know, if that's what they have. And also, that's for guys that don't really have a lot to say. You notice the more opinionated they are, the less it's about a uniformity of look. The less opinionated means their material is going to kind of go into, well, that's their version of saying something I've kind of heard before. Mm-hmm. But we'll enjoy his rendition of these things. But you won't walk out remembering it. But you will talk about how nicely he was dressed. Oh, who was that very nice man in the suit? I like that young boy. Which one was he? The suit one. I don't remember exactly. The suit one, you know. Oh, yeah, yeah. He was nice. He'll make a girl happy. And that's how you know he's not funny. Is when you know he'll make a girl happy. I'm kidding.
Well, I've had the greatest sets of my life, and the only compliment I ever get afterwards is, you were hysterical. My wife hated you.
Great. You know, I always describe your style as the aerostrike.
Mm-hmm.
The David Feldman style is you get hit halfway through your thigh with a hunter's arrow, a big barbed deer hunting arrow. Now, there's two ways to remove it. You could try to pull it out backwards, but it just leaves a conical shotgun hole in your leg after that. So what you have to do instead is put a rope between your teeth, get really drunk, and have a friend shove it completely through the other way and pull it out for you while you curse at them and try to fight. And that's what you do with a joke. You take a joke and you go, whoa, that's a harsh entry. And rather than apologize for the out, you just go, ah! You shock them into a laugh, you know, and then you got them after that. But it's great. I always loved that style.
I have an addendum to that because I've thought about this. Because you always say, if Feldman pulls the arrow out, he's going to do more organ damage than going all the way through. I also
the
think,
other way, yeah, yeah clean yeah. through.
I also think about getting lost in the woods.
There you go.
Whenever I think I'm on stage and I've lost the audience, I'm not going to retrace my steps because I don't even remember what they were.
Oh, yeah.
Just
keep
going in the same direction. Eventually, I'm going to hit the end of the woods.
Yeah, that's right. That's great.
Thanks to Donald Trump's environmental policy, it's going to get harder and harder to get lost in the woods.
There won't be that many woods.
Yeah.
You just don't turn right at Oil Derrick 7. the one that's leaking.
the issue of our time is the environment, and as
that's
you said, and water, and as comedians, I'm going to get back to comedians.
Okay.
We understand business better than anybody. Now, I have friends, because I'm back in New York, they look at me and they don't think I understand business because I'm not rich. And I'll go out with them and I'll say, F you, just because I don't have money doesn't mean I don't understand business. I understand exactly how business works. The 99%, we understand how business works.
That's right, baby. You're fucking A right. I hate being lectured about that by people who aren't in the same economic category. About they're trying to talk me into something that would be great for them, but not for me.
Yeah. I know how business works. And
yeah.
I wasn't cut out to sell my soul the way you are. I don't want to be as miserable as you are. That doesn't mean I don't understand that Exxon is going to just gobble up all the profits and leak methane into the air and destroy our planet because That's what they do, unless you regulate them. I know exactly how business works.
Yeah, right. And you're right.
But they're smarter than we are. And then they invent amortization, words like that. So you go, huh? I see, I'm smarter than you. I know something you don't know.
Right. It's the same reason Parisian French is so difficult, so that royalty could always spot royalty.
Really?
You could tell when the language is made so complex and nuanced that it was spoken poorly, that you could then go, oh, you're not aristocracy, because only one group gets trained correctly in how to say all this.
I thought it's easier to spot aristocracy by not being able to stop the bleeding. I thought the hemophilia was the tell.
the inbred hemophilia. Your Majesty, your eyes look much further apart today.
In the 70s, there was this thing called FM radio where jocks talked to musicians. Do you remember this?
Where? Yeah, of course I do.
So they would
have them on. They'd have them on the show.
And I can remember through my opiate haze thinking, you know, I like Eric Clapton. I like Elton John. I want to hear them sing. I really don't want to hear them talk. They're not as articulate as they think they are. But they served a function, and that was it gave the illusion of political talk. It gave the illusion of wisdom. But the truth is that John Lennon, you know, we love him. He was a wife beater, but we love John Lennon, and he spoke the truth cryptically. He spoke it cryptically. And that's what FM radio was in the 70s and the 80s. It was musicians nibbling around the edges of important issues. Jackson Brown, very important, wife beater. But Jackson Brown, very important. He beat up Daryl Hannah.
I read something about that.
Yeah, but great guy, you know, his politics are great. But he nibbled around the edges, and through poetry, we had to figure out what he was saying. I'm discovering, kicking and screaming, because I can't accept the fact that comedians are this smart, that that podcasting with comedians, certain comedians, is far more dangerous than letting rock stars talk about politics. It's far more dangerous to have Rick Overton talk about the environment than Sting. Everybody was okay with Sting going on talk shows to talk about the environment. But when you get Rick Overton talking about it, better be a podcast, because it gets too true. And that's where...
Oh, wow. Well, same with you, man. I mean, that's, you are getting a lot of truth out to people, and you're mixing it with humor, which is the classic spoonful of sugar to help that medicine go down, you know?
I think so much of the baby boomers' problems stem from listening to musicians who played Woodstock instead of the comedians. I think had we listened to Dick Gregory and Mort Saul instead of Roger Daltrey and Donovan and Joe Cocker, we might be a smarter generation. And this new generation...
If you're saying if we'd stayed a jazz crowd rather than a rock crowd, because a jazz crowd is where you would go to see the opening comedian, and maybe even then later another night that week at a jazz club see Lenny Bruce, and you mm-hmm. see, you know, one of the early comedians who are just laying the truth out with some embellishment of humor around it.
Right. The millennials, yeah. And I hate them for their youth, and I hate them for their looks and their sex. They have sex and they have fun and they're happy, and I hate,
that's all valid reasons.
I hate them.
The legitimate reasons right there.
They're better than we are because they right. listen to comedians. They listen to comedians.
Right.
They do.
They listen to Stanhope. He has a crazy millennial following, mm-hmm. which is good news. That's very good news. And you have an awesome following with the youngins.
Yeah. Yeah.
You got the kids following you.
We really... Our generation, the baby boomers, we deserve everything that's going to happen to us. We are horrible.
I don't think we all are. I don't think all of us are. There's some are. You know, this is look. And I also think there's the crop rotation. It's this giant pizza pie, but cut into only four slices, and only three segments of it is green, and there's that one brown dirt segment. The fallow field, they call that. The fallow field is a the 80s people, right?
Yeah.
The selfish 80s people that kind of came in at the lowest point of de-evolution for the species. But they are the shit that makes all these other plants grow.
Mm-hmm.
They're so shitty that shit makes fertilizer, and they're actually boosting a generation to be the opposite. Because when you grow corn, it's not shit. It's the opposite of shit. It's good. Or you grow any crop out of it, it comes out of shit.
Right.
But it turns into something good. And this shit is going to manufacture some good people are showing up now. And you're not hearing all. They're not getting the credit they deserve, but they're out there. And you're one of them.
If I could just get past saying to you, what if there's corn in my shit? What is that? See, if I could stop making those jokes, I could be one of them.
David, that's the pentimento of life. One.
I just can't.
Just under the surface, it's right there. You just get your little plastic spoon, your McDonald's spoon, and just scuff it back. And put, there's the corn. There it is. You got it. It's like a scratch and win. You won. You got three kernels. You win.
Here's the problem. Then I'll let you go, I promise. The problem is
I don't want to stop.
Okay, I have...
I miss you, buddy, and I don't want to stop. I like talking to my penalty.
I love you, and...
This is like the old days. This is like the old days, man. I love it.
I love you. Here's the problem. You said corn and shit, and I know my listeners are thinking, is David going to ruin the conversation by doing...
No, but there's a way to do it. there's a way to very subtly ruin it. ruin it just right, just perfectly.
Let me get back to millennials because.
All right, damn it! All right, God damn it!
All right, so I'm like really resentful about the millennials
for totally legitimate reasons, like they're younger and they have erections and their bowels are regular. Yeah.
Wait a second. You said they have erections. Doesn't that imply that their bowels are... Oh, I was going to make a bad joke. Okay.
I wouldn't want it to be corny. Hey, all right. God damn it. All right.
I'm a millennial because it takes me 1,000 years to take a dump. So the thing that I have said to some millennials, because I'm offended by their certitude, their political and moral certitude.
Right.
And I go, what if you're wrong? What if you're wrong? And I just realized they can't afford to be wrong because the clock is ticking. We were wrong. The baby boomers were wrong.
Some were, yes. A lot were right. Once again, a huge demographic is not being given credit for what actually happened. And we go to that sick parent of a media to get approval for it to say it loves us, but it won't. It doesn't know how. It's our sickness for going back to it, expecting in madness the answer that we know recidivistically we never have gotten before. Won't come this time, but we do it anyway. And the same thing with the truth and the media on that. And there's millions of people who agree with you and agree with me, but they're not getting the due in the media.
Name names.
The 99%. They're called the 99%. They didn't evaporate. They renamed themselves. They would put pink pussy hats on when it was called for, but that did not define them. And they weren't there to say, oh, yeah, and we're playing along with all of it. There's a gigantic demographic we belong to. That 99%, it doesn't meet in the streets, so you don't know they're there. They figured out you don't need the streets as long as we have the internet. So I suppose we'd have to keep a close eye on the internet, just as many other people are keeping a hand out to try and grab it from us.
All right, we have 4 minutes left. We have 4 minutes left. I want to end on an optimistic note.
Fair enough.
Okay. The July 4th weekend is coming up. People, people need to relax. You can't keep fighting.
That's right.
You got to replenish the soul. How important is it to take a vacation from Trump? How long a vacation can you take from Trump and what's going on in Washington? Or if you just continue to fight, and never take a break, will you succeed? Your father worked with a lot of African-American jazz musicians.
That's right.
What have black people taught Americans about the fight, when to fight and when not to fight? And speak to that in terms of getting permission from you to take July 4th off and not be angry.
I'm not angry now.
No, I'm talking about me.
Okay. All right. Then let's. Here's a lesson I think we got is the deadly hazard of comfort, the danger of comfort, and how it cripples a culture when potentially required to step outside of it to get something necessary done. The addiction to comfort that will stop what would be a logical move to step outside it to save yourself, but you'd rather be comfortable and die than discomforted and live. I guess it's like the only thing worse than going to the dentist is not going to the dentist.
Mm-hmm.
One hurts and the other will eventually kill you.
Right. So step out of your comfort zone.
Yeah, because that's all they've been forced to do pretty much the entire time. We have a comfort zone that certainly back in my dad's time was unheard of for the African-American community and is not in a very good place right now. We're in some ways returning back to it. I don't think it'll work correctly because they didn't have a previous reference to anything before that. And now they do. A reference point to progress that I think you'll try to undo, it just won't go right. We're seeing the first few months of something like an experiment, but are we seeing those experiments all succeed? I don't think we are. I think lots of these things are failing now. I think a lot of oligarchy is going face down all over the place. And I think some of the smart ones are trying to, you know, be a progressive version of that just to survive this because they know their version, their original plan version isn't going well. And that's all of it.
You have a black belt, right?
No, I just do kung fu. They don't give you a belt. They just let you keep doing it. So it's Krav Maga. Now, later down the road, I mean, I'm level 2-3 on Krav Maga right now. That's, for me, you know, before I did Kung Fu Wing Chun, and you didn't get a belt. You just work on, try to be good. Try to do good at it.
Okay.
Like, Chinese don't give a belt. In that system, in Wing Chun, you just practice. So the teacher says you're good.
Didn't you ask for a belt and they said no substitutions?
It doesn't go with the shoes, right? Yeah. I recommend everyone study it now because it's a crazy, unpredictably violent, weirdly out of nowhere, random, selected chaos, violent world. And everyone just have a little bit of a skill set. You don't know. I mean, they may catch you where you can't use it, but it's better to have it and not need it than need it and not have it.
So in the martial arts.
Yeah.
Trump fatigue sets in where you pick up the paper and you say, oh, I just can't keep fighting. I can't keep fighting.
I got to pick up the paper. I go, where did I find a paper? Hey, someone's still making a paper, everyone.
Yeah. You pick up the Kindle and you say, I can't take this anymore. Right.
Okay. Right.
What do you do and how long do you do it for? Are you entitled to take a break? How do you replenish? How do you, Rick Overton, replenish and then get back into the fight?
I actively try and do my comedy somewhere and improv. Improv gets me out of the slump. Improv. I get to laugh too, because it's the first time I heard it, and not just everybody else, but I'm just hearing it for the first time too. So I need some of that. Get some cheering up. Go do an improv.
Great.
Because it's about you surprising yourself. Because when there's uncertain times, we're mostly feeling self-doubt. And that's what the uncertainty of uncertain times is. How can I, will I be able to manage in a crisis time?
And that leads to anger.
If you're lost, unless you have a skill set that goes, no, yes, and push forward. Start seeing it as a puzzle to solve. Start liking solving puzzles to the point where it becomes sport.
Right.
It doesn't always work, but the more I treat it like that, the more it's manageable. I won't always say it's fun, but it's certainly a survivable.
Great.
And you treat it like improv.
How do people reach you, sir?
At Rick Overton.
On Twitter?
On the Twitter and Rick Overton's page on Facebook.
I love you, buddy.
Love you right back, old school. Let's talk once you hang this up. I want to keep on the line here and see what your world's about, buddy.
Oh, everybody makes fun of me now because on the show, when I wrap up a call, I say, stay on the line so I can do that.
Yeah.
It's become my catchphrase, stay on the line. And you just...
Yeah, why not?
You say, okay, hang on. Stay on the line.
I want to hear what's next.
If you're enjoying today's show, please share it on Facebook, Twitter, StumbleUpon, Dig, Reddit. Copy and paste the link to this show and share it with all your friends via email. Spread the laughs, spread the knowledge, spread the love.
Okay, we're rolling. I'm going to test you one more time. Ready?
Okay. Yes, sir.
I'm doing a sound check.
Should I speak a little bit longer than just two words so the sound check could be correct, more accurate?
No, it sounds good, but now I'm testing your memory. Ready?
Okay, that's even worse. Yes.
Who used to do this? Test, test, shit, fuck, shit, test, testing. Testies, shit, fuck, motherfucker, shit, fuck, test.
Who John did? John Cantu?
Oh, you're close.
Oh, is John right, or is it somebody who ran the zoo right?
John is right.
John Ross?
No.
John Means?
Yes.
Dr. Gonzo.
Dr. Gonzo used to do his sound checks.
Ding, 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 ding. Winner, winner, chicken dinner. Winner, winner, Sheen dinner. Oh, that's dating myself.
Mark Pitta joins us from the Bay Area. He was in New York City last week, and we got to hang out. You know, you're a better human being than I am. I just wanted to call and tell you that. I watched your trip to New York, and I realized you were better than me in every way. As a friend, as a comedian, as a man, you have this way about you, and you were in New York, and you visited friends. You visited Jimmy Celeste and Alex Bennett. I've been living here for 3 years. I haven't had time to see them. You hang out with people. They could be Dana Carvey. They can be the guy who used to clean your house. It doesn't matter. You're a man of the people. You're a good human being.
Well, I think if you live in the same city as your friends, you don't see them as much. But when you only have like 3 or 4 days, you seize the opportunity. So I'm never in New York, and I always find myself in New York going, oh, I get... And Alex Bennett had reached out to me when he heard I was going through a divorce, and he had sympathy for me. I went over there. He went out to dinner in Harlem, and it was fantastic. Took the subway a couple times.
I saw Jimmy Celeste. I spoke to Jimmy for a minute. I started to cry. I haven't seen him in 13 years. And then I start going, I'm a horrible human being. I've been living in the city all these years. I still haven't found time to see Jimmy.
Well, how far are you? I don't know where you live, so I won't. But how far are you from Washington Square Park?
I've become a shut-in. It's like, it's everything is work, stand-up. Can I get laid? Can I read? I've broken it down to the bare essentials, and I'm cheating myself out of life. I think I have it figured out.
Well, especially in that city, because there's so much. It's just fun to walk around. I might as well walk around and have coffee with a friend for half an hour. I'll be your life coach. How about that?
Okay. I had a great time with you. You were in town to pick up a Lifetime Achievement Award for a friend. He couldn't make it.
I don't. Stop it. I don't know if I want to ask this question now or after your listeners hear the story, but I think I'll wait till after they hear the story.
Okay.
I was in town because Jerry Lewis, Jerry Lewis is 92, and I think he wants to leave something behind. And he noticed that comedians don't get recognized. They hardly ever win Oscars. You could say Woody Allen, Kevin Kline, Fish Called Wanda, but a lot of comedy doesn't get a lot of attention, and it's the harder thing to do. The Mark Twain Award, okay, there's that, but I think Jerry wanted to establish something, because the Friars are like separate, it's just a different thing. So it's the Legionnaires of Laughter, and there's a lot of great comedians on the list, and I think he wanted to establish it, but the Lifetime Achievement Award will forever be known as the Robin Williams Lifetime Achievement Award. He wanted his name on that award.
Jerry wanted Robin's name on that.
Yes.
Award. Yes.
Yes. Because as you heard in the show, when I forgot who it was who was speaking, I believe it was Jerry's manager from Australia, who's known him 30 years, said when Robin passed away, Jerry turned off his phones for 2 days. And then when he finally spoke, he just says, I don't understand. And like we all didn't. And, it's interesting to see, you know, Robin touched a lot of people, but you forget he touched a lot of comedians too that admired him. And I was surprised to even know that Jerry Lewis felt that way about Robin.
Me too. I was surprised too. Jerry couldn't make it that night. There was a big dinner was it Cipriani's downtown?
Cipriani's Wall Street. Uh huh.
Beautiful location. And it
gorgeous. Yeah.
And this Jerry's kids thing. They go Jerry's house.
It's for terminally ill kids. There's one in Australia, one in New York, and it's kind of like a cool-looking hospital for kids. Like, everything's colorful, and, you know, and they try to make it for the kids not so horrible. And, you know, laughter does something scientifically to our bodies. It releases endorphins. So it's always better to laugh even if you're, you know, on your way out. Ooh, that didn't come out right.
Yeah.
I'm not a very good public speaker, as you know.
And well, we'll get to that in a second. It's called
Jerry's House.
Jerry's House.
It's actually, yeah, the picture of you and I that I posted actually says Jerry's House on the wall behind us. So it's Jerry's House.
By the way,
he's no longer really associated with MDA.
Right. So it's Jerry's House.
Mm-hmm.
And it was invented at the time by a 10-year-old Australian comic. Right?
I thought he invented the toy that Jerry wanted to fill the hospital with. This toy, you press a button and it makes a funny sound and makes you laugh for a second.
Oh, I thought that kid came to Jerry and said, what if?
He invented a toy. Yeah, he invented that toy. Oh, you know, there might be more of a correct explanation of how Jerry's House came about, but I'm still in a daze from that whole event.
So I had a great time because it was a rainy day in New York and you were staying at a really nice hotel. And I thought, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do what a normal human being does. I'm going to accompany a friend and just give moral support. There'll be nothing in it for me. I'll just hang out. I won't bring my microphone. I won't do a podcast. I'll just be.
Well, what was in the bag then, David, that you carried around?
Well, you never know if I want to stop being. No, I didn't. Did I bring a bag?
You know, had there been, it's in the photo. You have your bag. I think you had your equipment in there.
Oh, okay.
I'm surprised you didn't tackle, you know, Sherwood and Colin from Whose Line to get them on your podcast.
I think I was creeping them out. They were the hosts of the evening.
Yeah.
I kept laughing at anything that wasn't funny. So they were like looking at me going, is this guy trying to sabotage the evening? You went up, you did brilliant stand up. You explained why Jerry couldn't make it. There was something wrong with his what?
This is a label, Tommy. And it was a swollen wound. but don't lick it. No, I told the story of meeting him for the first time, which is a true story about me doing the Nutty Professor voice to him. And I don't know if you know this, and people listen to you from all around the country. There was a place in South Lake Tahoe, the South Shore Room in South Lake Tahoe at Caesars. And when back in the day, if parents brought their kids, they had to shove their kids into this movie theater that they had so they can go gamble. And they would play The Nutty Professor over and over again, or they would play Three Stooges in Orbit. Mm-hmm. And I watched The Nutty Professor so much, it was memorized in my DNA by that point. And when I met Jerry, I said, yeah, my mother wanted to take me to a doctor, because I would say, Mother, if you're making flapjacks or pancakes, as you call them, I would like my bacon crisp and the orange juice freshly squeezed. And Jerry said, that is the best Humphrey Bogart I've ever heard. By the way, that reminds me of that joke. The guy at the casino goes outside, finds a high roller. Can I borrow $300? How do I know you're just not going to, you know, gamble it away? And he goes, oh, I got gambling money. Okay, that's an old joke. I really shortened it, too.
I like that. Well, and what was the clown joke? What's that?
Clown? The clown joke. What? Wait a minute.
The depressed guy. Wants to kill himself. It goes to
a
shrink.
That's a famous joke. Oh yeah, you can make up the name of the clown, but it's the shrink tells the guy. The guy says, "I'm gonna off myself. I'm just life isn't worth it. Nothing's going right for me. My wife left me. My kids don't talk to me. I live in a hovel." And he says, "Look." The psychiatrist says to the patient, "Go see Puccinelli the clown." And I'm telling you, he's fantastic. So if you see Puccinelli the clown, you don't have a new way of looking at life, then we can talk. And the patient says, I am Puccinelli the clown. That says it all right there about comedy. Uh-huh. And the darkness of it.
Well, I don't think comedy itself is dark. I think what leads up to it is dark. What leads up to the show, and afterwards is dark.
I would think, you know, a lot of comics, and back when we were starting, there was maybe 600. Now there's so many, it's just ridiculous, and they're all influenced by other people. No one's influenced by the great comics anymore, I find, though. That's unnerving that comics don't know comic history. That's my biggest complaint about any comedian, though. It's like, you don't know comedy history? Like, it's all there for you.
But wasn't that the complaint? I remember in Mr. Saturday Night, he was saying, you don't know who Myron Cohen is? You must know who these people are. I mean, hasn't that been a complaint throughout time?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you could learn from everyone, you know? You can hear an old joke. Some like, Mort Saul was so in the moment, his stuff is hard to understand because you didn't read the paper that day, and that day was 1966 or whatever. You just, well, he was so on the money with topical stuff that you didn't really have to know history to understand that stuff. But
I should mention that Mark Pitta gets to have lunch or dinner or breakfast with Mort Saul once a week.
Pretty much. It's right now he's going through some tough times with his eyes, his vision. He's going to have an operation, and he's, you know, he just turned 90, and his memory is still there, great. He's a little slower. Got a hearing aid. Robin Williams bought for him, actually. But sometimes he hasn't ever returned my calls lately. I don't think, because he can't hear his phone and he can't find his phone. but you know what's funny about Mort is I could just go over there and knock on the door. Come on in, pal. You know, he's like that.
Uh-huh.
Open door policy. It's an open door policy here.
Wow. Wow. Up in Mill Valley, and he performs there every Thursday night. If you have Twitter and Periscope, you can watch him perform. There's a great interview that he did with Mr. Curtis, James Curtis, who wrote the new biography about him. Fascinating. Mort has some insight into relationships that he's been digging into since the 50s. He's been trying to understand women since the 50s. And before I got my divorce, I didn't quite understand what he was talking about. But now a lot of it makes sense, doesn't it?
What does that say about men and women that Mort's been trying to talk about this that long and we still haven't got the answer? That says, you know, they're still a mystery, these women.
Do you think this goes on in other countries, or is it just an American phenomenon? I think it's American. I think we're such a transactional society that people look at one another and they put a price on love, not necessarily money, but it's like, what can you do for me? I'll scratch your back. You fillet me. Everything is right. Don't you think? I don't know if that goes on in Italy, where everybody has health insurance and a safety net. I think people in Europe marry for love and not control. What do you think?
I think so, too. I tend to agree with that, although I haven't spent a lot of time in other countries to observe that. But, you know, like, I could see Italians going, andiamo, barbina, pool, come on. Is it? Andiamo is probably the only thing I know.
Now, when you were hiding out in Sicily, until things blew over, you had a girlfriend. She used to learn how to drive in your car, and she said you taught her the days of the week, right? And I think you have a tape of that.
I think Fabrizio.
Fabrizio, who's the guy you brought into the room when it stunk, and he would just breathe for a little while. And Fabrizio.
No, imagine that. The guy was the guy's name in Godfather, and like now it's a, you know, it's a something in the laundry room. Fabrizio. Yeah. That's him. Where is he now? Pizza? Okay. We take care of that. Well, you know, Pacino has several voices. The early Godfather Pacino is very nasal, and he's talking like this, like he's got braces on. And he continued that with Serpico. You know, where am I going to go? And then we had Dog Day Afternoon. This guy's so mad. This guy wants to kill me so bad he can taste it. And then he got older, and then it's like he had removed the braces, and the monster was released. Oh, then it came out like this. We don't know what happened. I claim, and I think I'm right, Dick Tracy turned him. Because Dick Tracy was the first time in all that makeup, but we knew he was like, I wanted generals. What do I got? What? Soldiers. And from then on, he did that the rest of his career. The yelling guy.
And I understand Bill Cosby is hanging out with you today, just kicking back. You're helping him teach.
Bill, do you want to speak to David again?
Talk to the guy with the plug.
Well, all right, come on. Bill, you're okay. Do you want to ask Bill? Here, Bill, take the phone.
Hi,
hello,
Bill.
David.
Hey, Bill.
Buddy.
Congratulations on the
miss. What's going on? Did you hear I got out?
Yeah, well, temporarily, sir.
Oh, it's just one in the many of a series. It's like having a TV show again and getting renewed.
I understand you're teaching a class in how to avoid getting accused of sexual assault.
You know, you got a lecture on what you know. And I know all about that, so I figured, you know, take my little tidbits of information and hand it out to the others, the people. I'm sorry, I'm laughing. I didn't expect to do this today. But, yeah. Oh, Dana Carvey just told me a story.
Huh? Oh, sorry, what?
I just, you know, my brain works this way, but Dana Carvey told me a story about, we were talking about Tough Guys, the movie, his first movie, and he made it with Kirk Douglas and Burt Lancaster. And he said that, you know, Burt was like 77. It's like, we're going to rob the bank. Line. You know, there were like 35 takes with Lancaster. Then they do coverage for Kirk Douglas. They did 20, 22 takes. Then they do coverage for Dana. And Dana would do his line once. And Kirk would go, I think we got it. It's a wrap. And he told me that Burt Lancaster and Harry Hamlin were at some press event where they were announcing something in the press. And this was, you know, Burt Lancaster gay. Everybody asked that, right? So they go back to the hotel, and all of a sudden, Harry Hamlin's got a knock on the door, and he opens the door, and it's Burt Lancaster. And Harry Hamlin goes, I'm not gay. And Burt Lancaster goes, I understand. And he walks away.
Wait.
Burr Lancaster was going to Harry Hamlin's room, and Harry Hamlin just said, "I'm not gay." And Burt said, "I understand," and walked away.
Like, what, Burt Lancaster?
Yeah, that was a big rumor for a while.
Burt Lancaster?
I'll take it back. To cut that out. I don't want to make people think I'm the one that outed him.
Well, got to keep that in now.
Okay. You gave my permission. Wait. What did it tell you about? You're going to tell me about the gay people. What are you doing? The guy was an actor. All right. Bill, I am trying to have a conversation with a friend of mine.
Okay, I'll let you know.
Let me tell your listeners, David Feldman, if you ever want him to laugh, just do Bill Cosby.
Did
you ever hear, you know what you asked me before? You said, what do you want to plug? Uh-huh. Well, I wrote a song about Bill Cosby that's on YouTube. To all the girls I've drugged before, why didn't I just buy a whore? It's worth listening to, because I rhymed some pretty good stuff in there. My favorite was TMZ on every corner. Even Malcolm Jamal Warner knows what I've done before. Yeah. All right, let's move on, David.
Is that really on YouTube?
Yeah, it's got a picture of Cosby from his album, and I scratched out his eyes. So it looks like, not happy about that. But.
Yeah, now you could get away with that because women don't find anything that comes out of your mouth offensive. If I did that, it would come across as trivializing what he did. Have you ever gotten
into trouble? Isn't that hard?
Huh? Have you ever gotten?
Isn't that the case about everything, though? It's like, if we have to second guess our jokes, that's going to be the downfall. You know, you got to try them all.
Have you ever gotten into trouble with women in the audience? I can't imagine you.
By saying something offending, you mean?
Yeah.
One time I did, but it wasn't the woman who was upset. It was her boyfriend. And it was Charlie Goodnight. That was in North Carolina. It was a Bay Area. It was one of those restaurants that had a comedy night.
Charlie Hebdo's. Was Charlie Hebdo's. It was a French restaurant. And
no, it was
Charlie.
Anyway, it doesn't matter what the venue was. But I was emceeing. I was very green, and Slayton was headlining, and I said something. This woman couldn't stop talking, and instead of doing the old heckler lines, I just said, "Ma'am, here's something you'll never hear. Oh, you smell good." and you're not going to believe this. And a glass ashtray whizzed by my head that Jesus. Her boyfriend threw.
Wow.
And it hit the back wall. That's how much on a flat. You know, I didn't. If that hit me in the mouth, it was over. Slayton comes out of the kitchen with a meat cleaver. Who threw that? Who threw the ashtray? And it kind of saved the day, but it was ugly for a while. So I learned a little bit that day. I kept the ashtray too. It's I had it for a long time.
I once had a woman throw a fork, and it hit me in the glasses.
Ooh.
Yeah. And I was in a bad mood. It was a fundraiser in San Francisco for Willie Brown and the Democratic Party. Must have been the mid-90s. And I had had it with the politically correct in San Francisco. I made a harmless joke about, I don't know, Hillary Clinton or something. A fork hit me right in the glasses. And I just stopped. And I made a big thing out of it. Because I just wanted to show how dangerous these liberals can be. And I kind of,
sure.
And the woman started crying and made me feel bad. She tried to make me feel bad that she threw the fork at my glasses and I stopped the performance. And she kept crying and she kept saying, "He was wearing glasses. He's not hurt. He was wearing glasses." And everybody was saying, "If he hadn't been wearing glasses, you would have taken his eye out." And I said, Larry Brown was with me, and we were just sitting in the dressing room, and I shut the door, and we were laughing so hard because these liberals in San Francisco were exposed for how hateful and dangerous they can be with this politically correct crap.
Well, the one guy I do remember getting into most trouble with women was Rick Reynolds.
Well, yeah.
He would have jokes just... they were so rude, I can't even quote them.
Me neither.
No, they're really bad.
I mean, I remember coming to Cobb's one night. He was headlining, and he says to this woman, "So you believe in Jesus?" And she goes, "Yes, I do." And you think he's going to punish me for not believing in him? "Yes, I do." And then he says, "Well, let's give it a try, shall we?" And he looks up to the sky, and he starts cursing out Jesus. Imagine the worst possible words you could say to Jesus. And then he pauses and says, I'm waiting.
Oh, you know what that reminds me of? That scene in Cool Hand Luke where it's raining. "This guy can have my life any time he wants to. Come on, old timer." You know, he's yelling at God. and the last line is, "Standing in the rain, talking to myself." But Rick was different. Rick was kind of a troublemaker, instigator.
We played a prison together.
You were there for that story? Oh, my gosh.
With Jose Simone, Joe Simon, when he's looking for work. And it was Santa Rita Prison, level 5. I mean, murderers, rapists. I got so claustrophobic. We go in there, and they're telling us, whatever you do, don't talk to the crowd, and don't make fun of the warden. That's the first thing. I go up. And I bomb, and they kept saying, "Turn around, turn around." And I'm thinking, I think my hair plugs are good. I swear to God, Mark, I swear to you. They keep screaming, "Turn around, turn around." And I'm thinking they're checking out my hair transplants. They want to see the bald patch in the back. And I turn around, and they start whistling at me. They were checking out my ass. And I never get any attention from women. And I'm thinking, well, this is kind of nice. I swear to God, this is kind of nice to be appreciated. And I shook my ass and they all cheered. And then,
oh my gosh.
Yeah. And then I get off stage and I'm really kind of scared. I just want to get home. I'm very claustrophobic. I keep thinking, they're not going to let me out. They're not going to let me out. Jose goes up and he performs, and then Rick goes up, and he was told specifically not to make fun of the warden. And the first line out of Rick Reynolds' mouth is, "Good evening, men and men." And he sticks out his index finger and he goes, "I just got finished finger banging Warden McGuire's wife. Line up here for a sniff." And the rafters start I mean, it's like I thought we had the prison riot in Cell Block 3. I mean, it was one of the worst.
Santa Rita. Wow. That's where, that's some famous people in Santa Rita. Yeah. Quentin had Charlie Manson. It still has Scott Peterson. Who is the madam? Heidi
Fleiss
was in Santa Rita. Yeah, she was in Santa Rita.
Have you ever played a prison?
No. And Robin Williams would always say, if you want to come with me to Iraq, fly with me because I fly with the generals. And I'm like, being in a Black Hawk helicopter, I would just be frightened. So unfortunately, I don't have that gene that says help others. But as long as I could drive home after.
I don't think
so.
I think I would go now. During the war, I was genuinely afraid of going over. Mm-hmm. I put out feelers. They weren't interested in me. I kind of did some things at a Marine base. They didn't want me. I didn't have the kind of act that would have worked for our soldiers.
I don't think I've ever told this story to anybody except privately, but I did a show. Excuse me. I was hired to do a show at Travis Air Force Base. It was a Christmas party. And I talked to the woman. I said, I just needed a riser, lights, microphone in the audience facing me. I'm good. And she's okay. So I get to the venue, which is some country club. And I walk in the room, and there's a band on stage. I'm like, yeah, it's perfect, perfect, good setup. Oh, but you're not doing the show there. Where am I doing it? And she kind of gestures to the lobby, and there was this overflow crowd that they screwed up, and they couldn't secure the room I was supposed to perform in. So they had a podium with one of those microphones that are attached to the podium. And I move around. I'm very, you know, I don't do one-liners. You know, you have to watch me full body. I said, I don't think I could do the show. It's like they can't, half the room can't see me. If I turn to the left, the other room can't see me. And the speakers were behind me, pointed to an empty dance floor. I go, this is the worst setup I've ever seen. and I said, well, you have to do it. So, well, let me go out to my car for a second. And I called the woman who had booked it. She goes, well, just don't do it. So I'm walking back, and these goons are out there, these tall dudes outside and they go, are you the comedian? And I went, no. They go, yeah, you are. What's the problem? I go, well, what do you do for a living? Air traffic control. I go, what if they took your equipment away? Could you do your job? He goes, let's talk over here. And he points to like the darkest part outside in an alley. I'm like, I'm not gonna go over there. and he says, look, and I'll never forget this. He goes, he points at me. He goes, we protect this country to provide you the freedom to do what you want to do with your life. And I looked at him and I said, who protects me from you right now? And let me give another shot. I walk back in and I look and I'm like, I can't make this work. I tried, I just can't make this work. And as I walk through the crowd outside, these guys with everybody who was there to see me, he's like, fuck you, get the fuck out of here, you fucker. I'm like, holy shit. So I get in my car, I'm like, whew, and I go to the club with the woman who booked me, and of course, couple glasses of wine. Then I tell the guy to fuck off. Then I change the story. But it was frightening. I mean, you can't do your job. And it's one of the few times I said no, and it was a good paying gig, but I just couldn't make it work.
Giving up. Yeah. Going to a gig and saying, no, this is horrific. You always end up blaming yourself. In the back of your mind, you're thinking, well, the show must go on. I should have done it. It's harder not to do the show than to just go up and bomb, humiliate yourself, right? It's harder to say no.
And if I was in my 20s, I probably would have, you know, said, yeah, it's a challenge. But after doing it for, you know, by then I was doing it 25 years. It's like, I can't make this work. And because I predicted that nothing would work because the audience couldn't see me, half couldn't hear me. It was horrible.
Ask Bill Cosby anyway. If he ever said no to a gig.
Bill I just looked outside. He's walking around with some woman. I don't know. He's way down the street now.
I have a picture of him.
Isn't that funny, David? Isn't it funny? I just described this worst gig, and then you and I were at this fancy gig where it was beautifully, you know, great food, people were dressed up, women in gowns, men in tuxedos. Although I look at the pictures now, and I'm like, wow, I got to update my tuxedo. It's pretty old looking. But because it was Jerry Lewis, I wore white socks, and I was proud of that because Jerry always wore white socks with his tuxedo to put the attention on his feet because he was taller than Dean Martin.
Now, I didn't know that you have the waterworks. I didn't know that about you.
I'm a very emotional person.
See, you're a better human being than I am. I never cry.
I have a sensitive nervous system.
I never cry.
This is what I wanted to ask you, and you have to be honest, is the fact that you're not emotional or didn't get emotional at the same time as I did, are you on a medication that stops that?
No.
Like antidepressants or anything?
No, I never cried. I always...
So you're just a... Oh, okay. Because for the audience, I was supposed to accept this award, and I had not talked about Robin in 2 years on stage in public. The last time I talked about him was the week after he passed away, and we had a slight... little memorial for him, but and there was the big memorial, but I wasn't a speaker. But before that, as you know,
that's right. I cried there. That's the only time I cried because they didn't ask me to speak. I remember crying.
Well, as you know, we were there, and before I have to go up on stage, there's this in memoriam with all these comedians that have gone. And when I saw Kevin Meaney, who we lost recently. I grabbed your hand, I squeezed it, and you kind of acknowledged it, but you weren't, tears were running down my face, and now I get introduced to accept this award for Robin, and I couldn't talk. And I, you know what? I almost had you come on stage to do a joke or two to like, you know, collected myself.
But I gave you words of encouragement, didn't I?
Yes, you did. I was crying. I said, David, I'm going to lose it up there. And you put your hand on my shoulder and you pointed your finger at me and you said, you are going to bomb. And that loosened me up because it got me out of my head. And then you said something else. I don't think.
Well, it's not.
Let's not go there. Yeah. But it's, let's just say comedians always laugh at this word because it's a shock word.
Yeah.
And, you know, yeah.
I said something to the effect.
Don't even give them clues.
I just said, you know, I know you're weak and vulnerable and susceptible to any advice right now, but I really think it could help your career. If you went
but
out
then
there,
I tried.
If you shouted out this, what?
I remember trying to make myself laugh and you, because I was emotional. Then I turned to you and I said in tears, like, Robin was the first one to offer me cocaine. And that was an attempt to make both of us laugh. But when I got up there, it was because, you know, I wasn't doing material. It was very heartfelt. And my voice, as you know, started to go and I sounded like the Godfather. And that's when I said, I'm a superstitious man. If my son should get hit by a bolt of lightning, I'm going to blame some of the people in this room. That I do not forgive. And they laughed, and then it got me out of my head, and I could speak.
Uh-huh. You were hysterical.
Yeah.
You were.
I kept looking at you for, you know, support. But you were there. If you weren't there, it would have been worse. So I was very happy you got to go with me and ride in the sedan and drive around New York.
It was cinematic. It was a rainy thunderstorm day in Manhattan, and we were protected because they sent you not a limo, some kind of Range Rover.
Okay. That's what they do now. A lot of SUVs or, you know, because people look for limos, you know, on these events and stars that want to show up, you know, not the Weaver stars, but, you know.
But Wall Street beautiful when it's raining? And it was very...
I'm glad I got to see that because it was a beautiful day, and there was a little humidity in the air, but it was a breeze, but that turned into thunderstorms, and then it rained violently for like 3 hours, and then when we got out of there, it was beautiful. The streets were wet, like some Hollywood company wetted the streets for the, you know, because it always looks better. And yeah, that was fun.
And they had beautiful.
And I got a little medal.
And how long did you stay there until? I had to go home. But
the next day was I did stay a long time after cleanup because I was talking to people and I was waiting for the same car to take me back. Because how many times, David, do you do a gig and they send a car for you, but after the gig, there is nobody waiting up for you? Like, there's like, hey, good luck getting home.
Right.
But they were really good about that, and a ride to the airport the next day. And I had a two-hour delay on the tarmac. I'm going to plug Virgin America, even though they were purchased by Alaskan Airlines. I'm on the tarmac for 2 hours because of the thunderstorms, and then we take off. So it's added 2 hours to the trip. I get home the next day, I get in the mail from Virgin, here's a $75 voucher because we know we inconvenienced you. Now, what airline does that?
Hmm.
You have to use it with them, of course. It's not like cash, but it's like, oh, okay, great, you know.
I'm going to Vegas
next week. So.
Did you sit on the runway out away from the gate?
Yeah, we were on the tarmac for a while, and then we had to go back to refuel because we burned so much gas just sitting there.
I hate that.
Yeah.
That's when I get my, well, I know we have listeners who are flying right now. And the one thing that I get antsy about is when I'm sitting on the tarmac. But remember to take deep breaths. And this is temporary. If you're sitting right now.
I fell asleep.
Well, you're a better man than I am. Did you drink?
No, but I had wicked, wicked dreams. No, I didn't sleep much the night before, so I was kind of tired anyway. And then, you know, it's so funny now. It's like you have so much to watch.
Wait, you were flying first class, right?
Yeah, but, you know, but Virgin has TVs at every leather seat, and they have, it's cool, it's low lighting, it's neon. I had my colonoscopy on a flight the whole night, and they... Anyhow,
I've had a lot of flights in coach that smelled like a colonoscopy. Yeah. I don't fly first class, but when I do, it's a completely different experience. On those rare occasions,
first class Virgin.
I'm sorry.
Virgin is good first class. Some first class are kind of upgraded business class, and they're not very good. There's no entertainment. The food's better. The food was really good on the flight. But anyway, but they were bought by Alaska. I just hope Alaskan Airlines doesn't screw it up because, you know, they figured it out. It's a beautiful, beautiful trip.
One day on this show, I'll tell the story of flying first class to Manhattan from L.A. and sitting next to Olivia Newton-John, which was...
Sweet lady, too.
Yeah, it was as close to perfection as it can get. It was heaven. It was 10 years ago. One of the greatest 6 hours of my life. It was not only first class, but she was talking to me, and I lucked out. I wore a suit because I knew I was flying first class, and she thought I might be somebody, but it didn't matter because she's just such a good person. And I got to talk to Olivia Newton-John for 6 hours nonstop.
Wow.
It was like, it was amazing.
I opened for her.
Really?
They were talking about winery. Yeah, and you know what? She eats with the crew and the comedians in her curlers. She's down to earth, you know? I was on a flight once where Tom Brokaw was in first class with me, and I noticed he didn't speak the entire time because his voice would have given him away. I can't get into the overhead compartment. How am I going to help me reach... pour by a bag, you know, it would have been that. And oh my God, Tom Brokaw's on our flight. I asked for a extra peanut. Oh, a peanut or two. Yeah. I'm doing Dana Carvey's version, by the way, I guess. You know, it's like Rick Overton says, when someone else does an impression that you've been working on and they go, oh, they decoded it. You know, like you know how our impression is done by the decode. Like Dana nailed it with, that is weird, wild stuff. You know,
Russ
and then
Burrow.
Boom, then we all, oh, that's how you do it. Okay.
Oh, I have some insight into that. Robert Smigel told me that Ed McMahon never uttered the words, you are correct, sir.
Oh.
Did you know that?
I tend to believe that, yeah.
Well,
President Bush never said not going to do it either. Dana did. Yeah. Not going to do it. And Dana is so great at...
did he say Shabashubi?
I don't know.
I'm pretty sure Dana's he said Shabashubi.
No, I don't think so. You have to prove that one. Dana loves to take an impression and just dissect it and then just make it so arbitrary and so weird that he, you know, not going to do it actually at the end would turn out to be not got that. He just loves to see how far he can take it, you know. Not dad that. Hi, Paul. I'm on a podcast right now. Telling stories, yeah. David Feldman? Yeah. Okay, Paula Carvey says hi.
Oh, tell her I said hello. I should mention that Mark is sleeping with Dana's wife. So we learned today that Burt Lancaster might have been a little light in the loafers, and Mark Pitta... Well, that is, if you're from San Francisco.
By the way, light in the loafers you can't say anymore, see? You can't
really
say anymore. You got to go with the times, yeah.
Who said light in the loafers is bad?
Johnny did that a lot.
But who said you can't
say... light in the loafers. No, I'm saying the political correct community won't let us do certain things. You know, you have to watch what you say now. It's kind of sad, you know? Oh, well. Roll with it.
So when you do Cosby, people, let me get back to this, because you know, we spent 10 hours together last Monday, and if you start doing Cosby, I start laughing. It doesn't matter. And I have said, people who listen to the show know, if I could do Cosby, I would talk like him forever. That's all
you
I would
call
do.
Up. Restaurants and get takeout orders. Could I have the pizza without the crust? Could I have Thai iced tea with the bowl with the kibashi bowl?
Do Bill Cosby calling Walgreens to see if his prescription is ready?
I was in there the other day, and I was using the machine that checks your blood, but they said I had to wait. They said they'd text me my prescription. And I was like, this is again, so I go order Rite Aid. And they don't aid you at all. So I had to wait, so I had to get it on the black market. Wow. Isn't it more fun to live with someone else? I never would have. I never think of these things on my own.
Well, yeah. So how did you know you could do Cosby? Like, when did you first do it? When I do I would never, ever do an impression in public. But when I used to do a lot of them, I could see the person that I was trying to impersonate. That was as mechanical as I got. Is there a mechanics to impressions when you say breaking the code?
Let me ask you this. Can you sing? Can you sing on key?
Yeah, I'd be ashamed to do it right now.
Okay. You may not have the ear for it, meaning there's something I think that we hear things differently and it's like being a minor bird, really. But I've never sat down and worked on an impression. If I tried it and got a little bit, then I would do it more. Like, as I get older, my Nicholson, especially in the morning or late at night, my Nicholson is much better. I actually had a great story about Nicholson. Adam Sandler was doing Anger Management, and he went over to Nicholson's house to discuss the project. Adam went over there, and Nicholson says, well, would you like something for lunch? And I don't know, just peanut butter and jelly sandwich, fine with me. You know, okay. And he goes outside, sits down the nice outdoor furniture, and then Jack comes out of the kitchen with two big jars, and he goes, Skippy or Jif? It's not even funny unless it's Nicholson saying it.
That's perfect. That's perfect. That's so perfect.
And Jimmy Fallon told that story about going to a ball game and eating Cracker Jacks, and Nicholson goes, did you get to the prize yet? And he goes, yeah, what is it? It's a little picture of a snake, a sticker you can put on things. When I was a kid, it was metal things. You used to get a whistle. Now you get a picture of a fucking snake. So it's just his delivery is, you can't. It's not. It's like Christopher Walken's funny because of his delivery, you know.
Now, did our friend Kevin Pollak decode Christopher Walken? Is he the one? Are we all doing his Christopher Walken?
He added. I heard some other people do Chris Walken, but he added the pauses and the whisper. You know, a lot of people do Walken. They just do this all day, but Pollak added the. All right. Don't even go there. Be sorry. Right there. You know, he did the almost the Pacino high and low thing.
Mm-hmm.
He does a really good one. Like the fact that Kevin has the stories to accompany his impressions. Like he met Chris Walken, as you know, they wanted Pollak there when he got his name on the star in Hollywood Boulevard, Chris Walken's star. And they were standing there by themselves saying nothing. It was creepy. And he goes, cement. Wow. And that was it. So, these true stories are the best. I don't know about you, but anytime I talk about other people, I do their voice. You can't talk about Jay Leno. One time I was on Jay Leno, and he said to me, "Hey, Mike, last time you were on the show, you did that thing." You know, you have to do the voices to everybody if they have a identifiable one.
The past couple of years, I've gotten to know Robert Smigel pretty well, and he's considered one of the best impressionists ever. Nobody knows that he's one of the best impressionists, right?
And, I didn't.
Oh, my God. He did the first Trump. He was doing the clutch cargos for... Oh, my God. He's amazing. Yeah, and he can... But I watch him, and he doesn't... Like, he'll do Cosby, and then he'll stop. And I often wonder... If guys like him, guys like you, guys like Dana, are afraid to get too deep into the impression because then you just don't stop. Because I'll shut up, but I think the reason I don't do impressions is I would be just a supreme a-hole if I...
I see. Well, why would, don't you think you couldn't stop?
Well, if I could do Cosby, I would...
You would stop.
I would just be making phone calls to Planned Parenthood, to, yeah. I mean, I would just, to women's shelters, to the NRA. I mean, I would just, David's can't come into the office today. He's taking a Bill Cosby day.
You would call Nobu. Can I have a table for two for 8 o'clock? I know it's a busy time, but I'm on the short leash. Yeah. Dana just told me, he goes, he says, you do Pacino so well, why don't you just take it further? Just do him in all sorts of, you know, situations. You know, he's always encouraging that. I gave him one the other day. He does micro impressions. I go, you do Nicholson, you don't have a micro. Do Nicholson at Baskin Robbins. And Dana goes, is there actual scotch in the butterscotch?
Later. How about doing it, I'll have butterscotch hold the butter.
Oh, that, ooh, I'll tell them that one. I'll have some butterscotch, hold the butter.
What's it from Five Easy Pieces? Hold it between your legs.
I want you to hold it between your knees. You see that sign, sir? I don't have to take any of your smartness or sarcasm. You see this sign? I got to kiss Karen Block once. Thinking of that sign. Yeah, think of that scene.
I kissed her once and her eyes straightened out.
Ooh.
That's horrible joke. That's just horrible.
Yeah, it's making fun of someone's looks. But she was a great improvisational actress, man. She was one of that whole group, Hopper and Fonda and Nicholson. Yeah, Dern. Have you seen Laura Dern on Twin Peaks? She is knocking it out of the park.
No, I'm just feeling bad about that Karen Black joke.
Oh, okay. I was trying to like get off that subject because.
That's what I do. You get to be like I realize that at Monday's event, you get to hang out and make people laugh, and I just say horrible things.
But that's your brand. So. Just stick with it. Well, do people know you were Feldo the Clown though?
Yeah, we keep talking about that.
Okay.
Show me how to do Cosby. I'm not gonna act like what
okay, what do I do? Let me think. Okay. I tighten my throat. That's what not my throat. It's my vocal cords. I kinda squeeze them. And then you go a little nasal and higher and you kinda slur. A little bit. You don't ever pronounce things exactly what you're supposed to. You know, maybe that's it. I've never. You can see me at the Learning Addicts how to do impressions.
Oh, why? You know what? I would give anything. I'm going to come to San Francisco and we'll videotape this. I have a money making idea. I actually have a money making idea because I now on YouTube they bump me up to something where I can actually charge for a video. Right. I don't know what that, what am I going to charge for? And I thought, well, wait a second. Suppose we do a seminar on how to impersonate Bill Cosby. Hmm. A master's class in impersonating Bill Cosby. And you actually teach people how to impersonate. I don't think that's going to make any money. I think I'm a very sick man. I think I'm sick.
I think we could officially say you lost your mind during this podcast. especially now. Well, you know, when it first broke about the allegations and all that, you know, I do a bit of my act about a GPS, celebrity GPS device, mm-hmm. which they actually have. You know, you can get John Cleese. You used to be able to get, you know, Dennis Hopper, Burt Reynolds did one. So I just took
the Fran Drescher didn't take off, right?
Oh, God. The Leno one was like, depends. You know, hey, last time there was a guy, and he put his blinker on, you sped up. Let him in, be a nice guy.
You got to reroute. That's okay. It's all right. You just reroute. You turn around. No big deal. No big deal. It's room for everybody.
Hey. Yeah, it's Bob's big boy. Might as well sound there. But when somebody yelled out Cosby, it's like it came to me. I think I could ad-lib. I could write better if I'm forced to in front of an audience. Like, I have to come up with something at this moment. my brain kicks in, and I just said, you go down the street and you take a left, allegedly. That was it. That was the entire joke. So, you know, my GPS bit has been on YouTube for about, since 2004, and it's got like 500,000 hits.
Wow.
And it's great. And then I get like an alert, like someone commented on your thing, and somebody writes, and I shouldn't even bring this up because it's nothing, but somebody writes, you're ripping off Jim Brewer. And I'm like, look at the date. I go, look at the date. I did it way before Jim did an impression of Pacino. And he doesn't do a GPS, but you're fucking ripping off Jim. And you realize you're just right. You're writing back 14-year-olds, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, just stupid, you know, so.
All right.
But I don't like to watch sitcoms. Or I don't like to be influenced by any comedy. So I know if I write a joke, it's mine. And that joke has been around for a long time.
Well, I'll write a comedy album with you. I would love to I would love to do a comedy album, but it would have to be like where you do all the voices and
yeah.
God, that would be so much fun. That would be just so much fun. You're in the Bay Area, and when do you see Mort next? Before you go, when do you see Mort?
If I'd probably go over his house tomorrow, maybe.
Wow.
I'll give him a call.
Wow.
You love Mort. That's great. You know, yeah. Robin Williams said to me one time we were walking back to the venue, and he goes, so great that Mort lives here. He just really loved the fact that he hung out with Mort a lot. We would have, three of us would have coffee. And then that's what hits you when you go on stage to accept an award on his behalf, and that's why the waterworks started. So,
yeah, that was a special night. Not to get too... Maudlin.
Maudlin?
But, yeah, but it was a special night, and I just was going for the ride. I just got to watch you and be reminded of how fun.
And I learned at that day you're a vegetarian and you don't drink.
I don't do anything. Everybody's having fun. And
this is the worst match.com promotion. I do nothing, and I have plugs, and I'm miserable. Date me.
Have you gone on any? You don't talk about the divorce, right?
Oh, not yet. But I'm banking a lot of jokes because my mind, you know, when you get divorced, it's emotional, whether you want it or not. It's on your mind all the time. And what else is on my mind is joke writing. So the two meet, mm-hmm. and what comes out of that is divorce jokes. It's just the way my brain works. So it's how I process things. And I will never say her name because then she could say I'm slandering her. But you could say I was married once. I do jokes about my first wife. I don't name her. So, but divorce is different. I'm accumulating a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And I would love to sit with you and write some more.
Do you know I have to write letters to my attorneys because I refuse to talk on the phone?
Me too. That's all I do now is like, really quick emails because they'll charge you for the minutes. I would tell my lawyer all these funny stories and I get billed.
So, yeah. So what happens is I had to have they love conference calls. Nothing good ever came out of a conference call.
No.
And I can't help it. I start making them laugh and I keep going, mm-hmm. deduct that laugh with 10 seconds. Take that off my bill. And then they start laughing. And I'm going, you know what? I realize I'm not funny. Just don't want to work. So you're just laughing. Ha, ha, ha.
Isn't it funny? You'd think both parties, once you've decided to get a divorce, would just take the steps as quick as possible to end it. Why stretch it out at all for any reason? I mean, I'm back to my life is totally different, and I'm into it now. And, you know, I have to take care of these other things. I have to sign some papers and get a notary. But that's like issue number 322 of things I have to do today. So it boggles the mind, you know, grudges, vindictive people, and you don't know they're vindictive till later. And all I did was support my wife as far as any projects she ever had. Or, you know, I spent money moving her only to say, you know, get divorced and I moved back. And but I have really, you know what I learned? I have really, really good friends.
Yes.
And everybody's helped me out. And it's I'm much happier now.
And I'm struggling with this, especially with my shrink and on this show. I keep saying, because it has to be this way, I keep saying it's America's fault. In other countries, they don't allow divorce attorneys to control what happens, and it's all about money and feeding divorce attorneys, and this is an adversarial country, we're warlike, and everybody doesn't have a safety net, so they're vindictive, they want what's theirs, because blah, blah, blah. Because the alternative, if I don't blame America, I'll blame women. And I don't want to go there.
No. Yeah.
It's more attractive. We've gotten to the point now where it's more attractive to blame your country than to blame an entire gender, which, of course, is not true. I don't blame women.
No. You know what I came up with? I said, what good is having a sex... Oh, I know. I used to say, what good is having a sex drive if all the roads are closed? And now, since I'm going through a divorce, I said, my sex drive is heading for exit celibacy. And one of my friends wrote, you can't get off there. And I'm like, okay, they don't know they just tagged it, and I'm using it.
That's a great joke. You can't get off.
Yeah.
Mark Pitta, how do people reach you, sir?
415. No, we did that last time.
But women love you. Women love you.
David, I don't want people to reach me, so let's leave it at that. Right. But I want to plug my Bill Cosby song on YouTube. Go to Mark Pitta on YouTube and click videos, and you'll see Cosby's face with his eyes scratched out. It's a funny one.
And did Bill come back from his walk?
Did he? Oh shit, he's walking. Yes. Would you like to say goodbye?
Yeah, goodbye, Bill.
Bill?
David wants to say goodbye.
Dave and Feldman, you are I love your work. I'm a big fan.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I do blame women. So there, we got a little bit of a...
Oh, man.
Stay on the line for one second. Enjoying today's show, do me a favor and subscribe to it on iTunes, Stitcher. We have a YouTube channel. It's just audio, but some people like to listen to this show on YouTube, so subscribe to our YouTube channel and do me a favor and give us a good review on iTunes. You'd be amazed how much that helps. Giving us a good review on iTunes moves us up. That's the way their algorithm works. So when you give us a good review on iTunes, you're really helping out. Joining us from Los Angeles today is Writers Guild award-winning comedy writer and comedian and roast battle champion, Dave Sirus. Hello, Dave Sirus.
Hey, how you doing? I don't like calling myself roast battle champion. That's just something the club owner called me once. So I just want to make sure everyone is clear. I am not self-proclaiming myself champion.
And what about this movie you're writing with Pete Holmes?
What movie is that?
I have it on good
authority.
I have it on good authority.
Nice Pete Holmes. I have heard you mention multiple times on your show that I'm writing with Pete Holmes, who I have never met.
Well,
but that's actually convenient for me because the person I'm actually writing the movie with, I'm not supposed to say publicly. So you did me a real solid.
Dave Sirus has written for Saturday Night Live. He's written for Triumph the Incel Comic Dog. He is a roast battle champion. That means everything to me. And
sure,
he won't admit it, but he's writing the big new Pete Holmes movie. That after after
I hope Pete Holmes hears this and gets really confused.
After the success of Crashing, I would assume you can't talk about it, but you and Judd Apatow are writing a big movie for Pete Holmes. You know what happens? If you tell a lie long enough in Hollywood, they go, what the hell? We might as well do it.
Well, lies are becoming more and more credible these days. So sounds like you just figured out how to get a movie contract.
On today's show, we're going to talk about the Cash Me Outside girl, our troll culture. We're not going to talk about Donald Trump and his tweets. We are not going to do that. And we're going to talk. We're going to try not to. And you are saying to me before the show started that elitism is a good thing. But you're at an In-N-Out Burger in L.A. as we speak. How can you be an elitist?
Well, I mean, Eric Trump was at In-N-Out, too, and he stole soda, if you remember. Saying he's an elite.
He stole soda?
Yeah, there's an Instagram photo somebody took with Eric Trump at an In-N-Out Burger, and you see he's holding one of those water cups, those little clear cups that they give you for water, and it's filled with lemonade, which means Eric Trump stole lemonade, allegedly.
In the name of St. Jude's.
Yes, of course. He is a very charitable person. I'm sure he just wanted to save every penny he has to give to some charity that will buy paintings of his father.
Maybe it wasn't lemonade. Maybe he was buying a hooker's urine to pour over his dad. Did you ever think about that?
Well, yes. I would think that now Eric Trump is going to be more concerned about where he buys his lemonade from and getting photographed with it, because that's a very good point. I would never drink lemonade again if I was in the Trump family.
I thought we weren't going to talk about Donald Trump.
Well, it's impossible. We're trying to talk about the 14-year-old troll girl, and the problem is it relates directly to Donald Trump somehow.
All right,
basically the same person.
Who is the Cash Me Outside girl? I have no idea what you're talking about.
First of all, I envy your life to not have to know who she is. She was a 14-year-old girl who was on Dr. Phil because she's one of these out-of-control, you know, juvenile delinquent-type girls. And she started threatening the audience when they were, you know, trying to ask questions. And she was like, well, cash me outside. How about that? And, you know, a little white girl who's, you know, putting on a voice and an inflection. And it's very sad because it's just, you know, it's a girl who's, you know, in trouble and you want her to get better. And the problem is she's become something of a celebrity now because people think that a child acting horribly is adorable, which is why it's hard for me to talk about this without bringing up Donald Trump. It's too many corollaries. So at first that was terrible. It was, oh, she's a meme. People are all quoting her and that's sad, but it was nothing. You know, now she's on tour.
Huh?
She's doing a tour where she is being put up and being booked places where audiences will pay money to go see her on stage and be mostly yelled at and insulted by a little girl. And a lot of people are upset. And the weirdest thing to me is that a lot of, you know, everyone, every comedian I know tries to be a contrarian. Everyone wants to have the new hot take on something. And I've heard people say things like, hey, you think you're cool because you're attacking this little girl because you think that she shouldn't be on tour. What's wrong with you? Leave her alone. And I'm saying, no. That's like saying if I don't want someone to give a gun to a monkey, that I'm anti-monkey. This is abuse. It's the same thing with Honey Boo Boo, where except that wasn't about a girl doing something horrible. It was just more about her horrible health habits. This is even worse. This is about someone who's actually a hateful, angry person, and we are making her believe that this is her ticket to her future. And instead of saying, okay, this is behavior we should all be looking at and saying you shouldn't do this, we are as full-throatedly as possible as a society saying, be as horrible a person as you can possibly muster, because that's what we are now. That's who we are as a culture now. And that is terrifying. And it's troll culture.
How did she end up on Dr. Phil?
Her mother brought her on. Her mother, by the way, not exactly a role model of mothers either, because it sounds like she's also kind of parlaying this thing too. But she brought her on, like, you know, all these shows. This girl was on Dr. Phil because her mother brought her on to say, you know, my daughter's out of control. She's doing bad things. She's too young to be acting this way. I'm scared. And she, you know, she didn't know what to do. And, you know, for many years, we've had that show where some guy comes on and says, I'm going to put you in military school. I'm going to teach you to be better. And the kid cries. And it's not exactly, you know, the most honorable thing, but at least the spirit is somewhat understandable. This girl is a celebrity now. And now this girl.
She's 14, right?
Yeah, she's 14. She's 14 years old.
And she dropped out of the seventh grade.
She's 14 years old. Yeah, she's a little girl. And it's one thing to celebrate, you know, horrible people on a reality show, but now we're doing it with a minor, someone whose future really is going to be screwed up by the absolute worst kind of negative attention. We are teaching her and pretty much every other kid out there, be a monster, be a bad person, and you will be rewarded for it.
She has 8.3 million followers on Instagram. I'm getting a printout on her.
Yeah. There you go. Get her dossier out.
If I do a carefully constructed joke on Instagram, I'm lucky if I get 20 likes. But if I right. were to flash my vagina...
Well, if you flashed your vagina, it would get more than 8 million views. That would be a big deal. People still remember the 90s enough to know that David Feldman being a woman all this time would be a big deal.
I was Sharon Stone's stunt double in Basic Instinct.
I mean, I would love for the news, for TMZ to be like, remember the show MTV Half Hour Comedy Hour? Well, one of the guys who was almost on it turns out to be a woman.
By the way, I was on MTV Comedy
Hour. Oh, you were? That was a random guess. I assumed that was one of the ones you were likely to be on, but I figured you're more of an Evening at the Improv guy.
I used to go on all the time, and back then, I was too old for MTV. Back then, they were saying to me, we're putting you on as a goof because you're so old. And that was 20 years ago. How is Los Angeles today? Is it hot?
Oh, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful mid-80s June day. It's great. You know, I miss L.A. All my friends are here. Even though I feel loyal to New York, I you can't deny how great it is to be here.
Are you going
to
do stand-up tonight?
No, I'm going to do some tomorrow.
Where are you going to perform? Where are you going to perform?
I think I'm doing the Lexington tomorrow.
What's the Lexington?
Just some bar... It's a bar in L.A. that I do often because my friends run the show. I honestly haven't been trying to book that much stand-up just because I get a little overwhelmed sometimes with, like, the work schedule. So I just kind of do my friends' shows, and I'm not trying to, like, do the clubs necessarily.
And when is your next roast battle?
Well, I should have one in New York before August, but I now have one at the end. On August 29th, I'll be headlining the roast battle and a main event against the great Toby Mirashanu. One of the absolute best battlers in the scene.
Hey, did you write for Rich Voss's roast Monday night?
No. No. Did you do it?
He asked me to, and then I forgot about it. So.
Right. I was supposed to help you with that, wasn't I?
Uh-huh. And then I kind of sent him an email in the middle of the night earlier in the week. I go, oh, my God, I forgot to give Rich jokes. And I texted him and emailed him, and he goes, it's too late. So we'll be... Hell to pay.
That's too bad, because I wanted to tell you that Rich Voss looks like a rat in a Jew costume. And I guess that's just wasted now.
Are you still undefeated?
Yeah, but I'm only 4-0.
But what's Dixon?
Dixon's like 7-0, but I don't know. Well, 7-0 at New York Comedy Club. He's lost some at the stands. I don't know what his full record is. So he wouldn't be called undefeated necessarily in the roast battle scene. But he just has more wins at New York Comedy Club. But I don't know if he's still doing them regularly.
My resident conservative, Pat Dixon, the most despised guest in the history of a David Feldman show, Pat Dixon, is 7-0.
Because hosts don't count.
He's undefeated. Yes. Undefeated.
Yeah.
I don't mean to dispirit you, but put aside your self-righteous indignation and do an assessment of where we're at politically. We lost in Georgia, right? Ossoff lost, our guy. Karen Handel won. Pat Dixon, the great Pat Dixon, undefeated in the roast battles. The Supreme Court has just ruled that Trump's travel ban, parts of it can stay in effect until it goes to the Supreme Court in October. We're losing.
Yes. Trump did just tweet that he was happy about the 9-0 decision to uphold part of the travel ban. Not 9-0, 9 in the letter O, which makes me feel less safe than the travel ban.
You're afraid that he's going to drop a bomb on ground O.
Yes. I think that is the kind of mistake that should not be okay for a president. It's like if a doctor was about to perform surgery and realized he was only wearing one shoe. You would be upset. You would be worried about that. It's like if you were about to go on trial for murder and your lawyer said, "I'm sorry, I'm very upset. I just lost a bunch of money on WrestleMania." You'd be really worried.
How are his tweets? Are you one of his followers?
I am a follower of his because I do want to get them the second they come in case I happen to have something hilarious to say. But I wake up every morning with this litany, and it puts me in a bad mood. I have to, you know, because you just have to stay up. I mean, this morning today, I wake up and if anyone else in the world was tweeting something like this about a crime they were accused of, it would be the most hilariously guilty thing you've ever. He is acting like the most guilty person I've ever heard. He's now saying that I didn't collude with Russia. Obama colluded with Russia to get me elected. This is something that a person who's just in the deep throes of just madness would say. And he's also saying that he was smart to pretend to have recorded Comey because it kept Comey honest, which means he just admitted that Comey was telling the truth. He's an idiot.
We're coming up on the July 4th weekend when people want to relax, hang out with the people they can tolerate. Do you think Trump fatigue sets in once again for a couple of days where you just need a break from it all? And then when you need a break from it all, they come in and start stealing more stuff from us. It's constant vigilance. I respect that about you. You are like still outraged. And I'm thinking, can I just get like 3 days where I don't have to follow the Russian investigation and the travel ban? But you're still fired up, right?
Oh, absolutely. I actually had a conversation with a stranger a few days ago, and she was from Egypt. So I was especially disappointed in what she said. She was a very beautiful woman, and she just said that, I just think people need to calm down about Trump and just let him do what he wants already. And, you know, she goes, "People make him too big a deal." And I said, trying to be polite, and I said, "Well, I think Trump is like a starving dog. You look away for 1 second, he's going to eat the baby."
Exactly.
And I think the only thing keeping him even slightly worried about doing something catastrophic is his desperate need to be liked. And I think that we have an absolute responsibility to not let up. But at the same time, we have also the big responsibility to not exaggerate, to not lie. And that's a problem that everyone has right now on every side. You cannot misrepresent anything. You cannot use straw man arguments because we don't need to. And people keep assuming that these are lies about him because they can't believe that he could be responsible for such an avalanche of horrible things. But he is. The last thing we need is to misrepresent it. If you see a meme out there, Google it. Do not just assume the amount of money it costs for Melania to stay in Trump Tower. Google it yourself. Really find out. Because when you say it's more than it was, you just gave that conservative an excuse not to listen. That's what I think is the most important thing. We need to be honest, and we need to not let anything go that we wouldn't have let go if another politician had done it when they had a normal record? Like, if it's something that George Bush would have gotten in trouble for, we have to attack him for it. We can't just say, because you're such a horrible person, you should be allowed to get away with more stuff.
Jared Kushner has put in a bid for the new FBI building. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
Yeah, I mean, it's overwhelming. The FBI is going to build a new building, and it's about $2 billion, I think. And Jared Kushner's family has put in a bid to build the building that's supposed to put him in prison. Did you know that? No.
I did not know that one. I'm ashamed that I didn't know that. And that is so amazing, and it's amazing that that's not surprising. This has always been a cash grab. I mean, it explains why Trump loves Russia so much, because he's also treating this country like a kleptocracy.
It's...
Well, you know what it is? It would be irresponsible for us to just take a break from how bad things are getting, because when you do that, you give a pass to his fans.
Mm-hmm.
You let them have a nice weekend. You let them feel like this isn't so bad. Life is back to normal. It was all politics. Well, it's not all politics. He's not George Bush. He's not Mitt Romney. He's not Ronald Reagan. He is a mentally ill man-child filled with malice. He is the first president who I truly do not believe is concerned with the future of the country. I did not think George Bush was a good president. I never thought he was a bad person on this level, even close.
Right.
George W. Bush. George H.W. Bush was a horrible person, but a good president.
In an authoritarian regime, the way you take power is by exhausting the opposition. Like you said, we don't have the stamina of a hungry dog.
Mm-hmm.
I am right now in preparation for the July 4th weekend. I took maybe 6 hours to walk in the park, and I thought, well, the sun is shining, the leaves are on the trees. Life is good. Why am I getting so upset? Do you think Mike Pence, now that he's hired an attorney, do you think it's possible he could end up going to prison because of the Russian scandal? Who's in charge after that?
Paul Ryan. It'd be Paul Ryan, right?
Nobody really knows. They think they know, but when you...
No,
the line of succession.
Line of succession is very clear. When I did a cartoon once, I had...
Tell that to Alexander Haig.
Well, Al Haig was wrong. Al Haig said the Secretary of State was next, and he was 100% wrong, and it confused a bunch of people. The Constitution's very clear about this. The Speaker of the House is next. No question. But I do not think Mike Pence is going to be in trouble. I think that because every single person in that White House, everyone, is more loyal to the office than Trump himself, except for his children, I think that they've been insulating Pence this entire time. I think that everyone who works there in the back of their heads knows that Mike Pence is probably going to be running for president in 2020.
Right.
Because he's already president as an incumbent. I think that Trump has no loyalty from anyone, really. They're all just doing this because he's a useful idiot to them. And I think that everyone in that cabinet is basically just, their top priority is protecting Mike Pence from the assassination attempt that is Donald Trump's presidency against him.
Mm-hmm.
Metaphorically. I don't want to confuse anyone about what I just meant.
Rick Perry testifying, denying to Al Franken that carbon dioxide emissions are the primary cause of global warming. The attorney general testifying that he hasn't gotten around to investigating Russian collusion in our elections. Even though he's recused himself from the Comey firing, he's still the attorney general. He's supposed to order an investigation into possible tampering by the Russians. And he says, I haven't gotten around to it yet.
Maybe I'm a cockeyed optimist, but I still believe that we are approaching an absolute cratering of this entire regime. I think it's a godsend. It's a blessing that Trump isn't smart enough to pull this off, because if he was, we'd really be in trouble. But I think that they are so deep in BS right now that there is absolutely no... I mean, it's only been a few months, and this is worse than even the people like us thought he would be. I do not think they can maintain this. We need to really get all the people who supported him to go back to where they were before, of it just accepting the fact that they're just inferior and that they need to not think they know what they're doing.
Mike Flynn was what? The national security advisor, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. For like 24 days. He was being investigated before Trump was even president for possible collusion with the big Russian ambassador who's also a spy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Trump knew this. Prince Priebus knew this. Mike Pompeo knew this. He was the head of the CIA. They knew that he was possibly colluding with the Russians. And yet, for the 24 days that he was our national security advisor, General Mike Flynn was sitting in on all the intelligence briefings. That in and of itself is shut this administration down.
Well, I have a theory about that. And it's not exactly an original theory, but I really am starting to think that Trump was instructed to make Michael Flynn his national security advisor
by
someone with blackmail material, by someone who may be blackmailing him. If I was watching a movie, that is what I would predict was about to happen, because it's almost too stupid. That to call it incompetence is naive.
Mm-hmm.
I really think this is, I think that in Trump's mind, he thought, I did nothing with Russia but take their advice about one hire, which, you know, if you watch The Americans, you watch spy movies, you know, that's the grand chess move. That's the checkmate. And I think he's that ignorant about this.
I think we're all ignorant as to the venality of Putin. He tampered with our elections. He cracked open the DNC database, but he stopped right there. He didn't find out anything about Paul Ryan. He didn't find out anything about Trump. He just stopped with Debbie Wasserman Schultz and the Bernie campaign and Hillary. And Putin said, I'm done. I'm sated. Of course not. You know, Jason Chaffetz, who used to be head of the House Oversight Committee until he stepped down mysteriously and was replaced by this gouty freak. Why do you think Jason Chaffetz stepped down?
Well, I think Jason Chaffetz stepped down because he ran out of acorns and needed to go stock up again.
Why do you think Paul Ryan is towing the line?
Because he's a company man.
Putin's company?
The Republicans. I think that he will die on this particular sword. And I think that Paul Ryan knows that if he plays his cards right, he will be president.
I was involved in a civil lawsuit. And one of the questions they ask you in a civil lawsuit.
Are you talking about your divorce again?
No. I'm
really
just talking about a civil dissolution of a business. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And in a civil lawsuit, which is far different than a criminal prosecution, mm-hmm. a civil lawsuit. Have you ever been sued? Have you ever been divorced?
No.
Okay. The way a civil lawsuit transpires is there are two tracks. There is the legal track, and then there is the public relations track. There is the track of what are you afraid is going to come out and be revealed about you. That track is extrajudicial. It has nothing to do with what the judge is going to see or rule on, but it's a track that informs how you behave in court. Do you have anything on you, Dave Sirus? Is there anything for $600, if I hired a private detective, which I could do legally, I could find some stuff out about you. Is there stuff?
Nothing that I could imagine would hurt the career of a comedy writer. You know,
most people, most normal human beings, and we're not normal. Most normal human beings have stuff that they don't want revealed. This is what I've discovered.
Oh, yeah.
What don't you want people to find out about? And I go, nothing. And they go, come on, what do you got? I said, well, first of all, if I got something, I'm not telling you. So do some oppo research on me. There's nothing on me. I read the National Enquirer. Sometimes I pay cash for the National Enquirer. But most people aren't you and me. We're like sick. We're so clean because all we do is live for comedy or podcasting. Do you have things that you want to hide? And the answer is no. Most people do, including Paul Ryan.
There is stuff that every politician has. Anybody who's in Washington, D.C. has something to hide.
And you really think that Paul Ryan might be on this list of compromised people?
Well, I don't want to give Putin supernatural powers, but I think anybody who is as rich and powerful as Putin got there because he has a spy agency at his disposal. This was the guy who used to head the KGB. If he found stuff in the DNC, why would he stop there? Of course he's going to go. He knows about the three branches of government. Why would he stop with Hillary? He hacked Paul Ryan's account.
We don't know that Paul Ryan has anything that damning. I just don't think that Paul Ryan's behavior needs to be blackmail. I think it could just be him being incapable of breaking from his pack and thinking that I need to just toe this line and I'll get to be president in a few months.
In politics, there are three tracks. In civil litigation, there are two tracks. There's the track that takes you into court, where you follow the rule of law. And then there's the second track, which is more important. That is what is going to be revealed about you and disgrace you in the court of public opinion, what your kids or your wife or mistress are going to think of you. That second track is way more powerful than the first. In politics, there are three tracks. There's your political career. There's the track of the crime you commit while in office. And then there's the third track, the court of public opinion. What we can find on you that will destroy you in the eyes, not only of your voters, but your family, your wife, your mistress. Paul Ryan looks like a piece of shit dressed up for Halloween to look like Eddie Munster.
Yes, that was the first one we all thought of, yeah.
It's like a piece of shit decided it wanted to go as Eddie Munster for Halloween. He's obsessed with his looks. He's always working out. There's some dirty, dark secret on Paul Ryan, the same way there was a dirty, dark secret about Dennis Hastert, who was the Speaker of the House before John Boehner.
And got the job because he was so clean. Well, clean in the sense of not having any dirt on him.
No, you know, no. He got the job because he was dirty and could be controlled. Dennis Hastert is a child molester.
Mm-hmm.
He was the wrestling coach.
Don't even have to say allegedly anymore, right?
Right. He was Dennis Hastert is a child molester. That's
why he paid the kid off.
That's why he was made Speaker of the House by Tom DeLay and the Republicans, because I have something on you. I can control you. Right?
Wow. I mean, that's certainly, it's possible. That is the dark end of things, but it's certainly not implausible.
That isn't the dark end of things. That's the way it works.
I feel like they wouldn't do that because that opens them up to ridicule more than anyone else. They would want someone that they thought was clean. I mean, he's representing them. Just because Tom DeLay wanted someone he could control?
Who's naive now, Kate? Who's naive now, Kate? Do you think the Republicans care about humiliation? That gives them an erection. Look how Trump is being... Trump is constantly being humiliated. Trump is a national, international disgrace. The Koch brothers don't care. The bottom line is going up. They're happy. They're getting more money. They don't care. You cannot embarrass the Republicans. They're shameless.
Well, I think you can't embarrass Trump because he's got that kind of mental illness. I think the other Republicans, I don't think any of them really want the situation. They just are incapable of standing up for what's right if it's against their side. I don't think Dennis Hastert was helpful to them.
He was a useful child molester. Stalin had his useful idiots. Republicans have their useful child molesters. There was an epidemic in the early 2000s of Republican child molesters.
Well, there were plenty, and luckily enough, currently, conspiracy lunatics think that it's the opposite. They think that there was some sort of liberal conspiracy to molest children, which just as easily could have been just normal COINTELPRO because, well, if we're molesting children, I guess what we have to do is start saying they are.
Exactly. That's exactly.
I know people right now who think that there's some kind of liberal conspiracy. You know, I actually know someone who's also mentally ill who believed in Pizzagate. And I tried very hard to convince him what was going on. And, you know, but that's the problem when someone's schizophrenic. You cannot
teach them reason.
I want to get to Alex Jones and Pizzagate and Megyn Kelly. And I'm not being a contrarian. I actually believe Megyn Kelly did a pretty good job on her show with Alex Jones. I'll get to that in a second. But I want to get back to projection, the idea that if I'm a child molester or I'm surrounded by child molesters, the other side must do it too. No.
Something very specific to Trump especially, but the Republicans do it.
Do what?
They will say whatever you think, whatever they know you're thinking I am, I'll say it's you, and then we can change the conversation from I did this to, oh, everyone's just throwing this accusation around.
Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi are ineffectual, and they should be disappeared by the progressives in our community, but I don't think they're perverts. I don't think Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi are deviants when it comes to sex and family. I think they're pretty clean. Yeah. I don't think you can find anything on Chuck Schumer other than maybe some faulty accounting from Wall Street. Same goes for Pelosi. I'm sure you could, the same way you can find some stuff on Bernie and his wife with this college grant, faulty accounting. But deviance, when it comes to deviance, I think every Republican, mm-hmm. I mean this, every Republican who's gotten elected is a deviant. I think they're sexually deviant. They're either into something that's illegal or they can't have normal sex or any sex whatsoever. They're consumed with hatred for women because they're not into women or women aren't into them. So they want to control their bodies out of revenge. And that's what the Republican Party has shown itself to be. It's a party of people who lie and lie to themselves. They don't care what the truth is when it comes to the CBO, what the facts are. They continue to preach supply-side economics. Look at Sam Brown back in Kansas. You have a governor in Kansas who's still preaching supply-side economics, even though, as a test case, Kansas has proven that when you cut taxes, you increase the deficit and you increase poverty. But Sam Brownback, what a great name. That's my story and I'm sticking to it.
Well, they decided a long time ago that facts don't help them. So they're just going to poison the well of information until facts don't really exist in an objective way. That's something that they've accelerated now. And by the way, just to make one point about, they do have a tendency, especially Trump, to just accuse everyone else of whatever you think they're doing, to the point that I'm sort of predicting right now. At some point, Trump is going to randomly say something like, you know, I heard Barack Obama beat his wife, and then everyone's going to need to check on Melania. That's how bad he is at this.
Oh, so once Trump says that Barack Obama beat Michelle, that means Trump is actually beating Melania.
Yes, I'm saying that's how it's going to work. And we pay very close attention to what he randomly says Barack Obama did because it means he did it.
Well, I think you're right. And I think that Trump is going to say Barack Obama gave Michelle two black eyes. She's actually white, but to cover up the two black eyes, they had to change her pigment.
Well, I wish that was a ridiculous thing for him to say, but it isn't really.
So,
pretty reasonable.
So this is the new meme coming out of the Trump mind. Michelle is actually white, but they've changed her skin color to cover up the two black eyes that...
If he said that, it would be a half of a day news story.
Well,
you've
invigorated me. A lot of people are going to be listening to this show sitting on the tarmac, flying somewhere, but sitting on the tarmac, they can't take off because why? Because of climate change.
Know.
Because of climate change.
Oh, sure.
Flying is turning into a nightmare. Arizona, they had a delay in one day, something like 60 flights because it was just too hot to take off. So a lot of people are going to be sitting on the tarmac trying to get somewhere this July 4th weekend, and they're not going to be able to because of climate change. And people think they're going to relax. I'm hoping to relax. I'm trying to get everything off my desk and go visit my sister in the country for July 4th. And I have Trump fatigue, and I am not entitled to Trump fatigue. And when I get off the phone with you, I'm going to read off a list of outrages so people remain pissed off during their July 4th.
We can't let go. If we let go, the dingo will eat the baby.
What about let go? Let go and let God. What about that?
I mean, I'm not exactly like an ardent atheist, but the last 6 months hasn't helped. I think the fact is we've seen people who believe in God most wanted, and we need to accept that it is the worst thing for us now. This, I mean, especially because it's impossible to argue that there's anything about Trump that is that makes sense for a godly person to like. So in that sense, we at least we get for the rest of our lives to get to say, you don't get to talk about character ever again. You don't get to talk about values ever again, because you chose the person with the least character in the history of American politics.
And why do the Republicans cling to religion?
Authoritarianism, the same reason they like Trump. It's just two different sides of what makes people join a cult.
That's interesting.
And Donald Trump's popularity is cultism.
It's authoritarianism. And you also have to let go and let God. You have to believe in a higher power. Let them take care of everything for you. You have to trust them.
And as soon as you stop, and I said this to someone, actually it was during the same conversation with the woman who said we should just let him do it. Someone else said, hey, you know, you got to let, he said, actually, God will take care of it. And I said, that is the most dangerous thing you could possibly say. Because the second you stop believing that we are a rock in space, absolutely capable of killing ourselves off forever, you are making a horrible decision, because we have to accept we have completely within our power to murder us all if we don't stay vigilant, if we don't have the intelligence, if we start acting like everything's going to be taken care of by God. And, you know, we've done that slowly with climate change, but we can do it very quickly with Trump if we act like it's impossible that one egomaniac might just kill us all.
So as I go into the country and I look at trees and I see nature, I cannot trust God to protect me. I have to protect
nature.
I have to protect God.
Yes.
I have to protect God and nature from Donald Trump and Rex Tillerson.
Yeah.
And Rick Perry.
I think there might be a God. I think there might be a God. And if there is a God, he needs for us to do that. If God exists, he is certainly not hands on.
Well, unless he's a priest.
God helps those who help themselves. Yeah. But yeah, if one thing we know for sure is that God doesn't jump in and take care of catastrophes. That's our job. He gave us the tools to do it.
How about this? God is a baby. God is the baby Jesus. And we have to protect the baby Jesus. How about that?
I'm fine with that. Hey, look, Jews never seem to have anything bad to say about Jesus. Our problems are always with Christianity as a power structure. Mm-hmm. I've never heard, you know, Jews, I mean, nobody. No, Jesus never said anything that is that big a deal. That, I mean, in terms of like being offensive, Jesus said good things. He was a good guy, whoever he was. It's the people who, you know, worship him are the problem. And that's why they never seem to quote Jesus either. The real Republicans, they're big Old Testament fans. They want to talk about fire and brimstone and obedience. Mm-hmm. You know, if they talked about Jesus, they'd have to admit that they should be voting for Bernie Sanders.
Mm-hmm. You've revved me up, my friend. You got me angry. I'm going to go visit my sister. I'm going to go see the trees. But I'm not going to think that God will save us. It's my responsibility to save God.
Yeah, we could just as easily be living in a world where we all worship Zeus. It's not, it could have easily happened. And if that were the case, you know, we'd have people doing the exact same thing and saying, oh, well, there's lightning today, so that means everything's fine. No, we're on a rock in space. We are flying through space. On a big circular rock, and if we screw up, it's over.
Now you go to your shrink. Do you? I don't know. It's none of my business if you see a shrink.
Not since high school.
God, I hope.
I haven't since high school.
Well, anyway, everybody needs.
I am a shrink.
You are a shrink.
I'm a shrink to several people in my life. I'm an unlicensed psychiatrist, I assure you.
You should open up a practice where you tell people not to relax, not to calm down, that they're wrong, the people in their lives are wrong, and you need to lash out and expect things from people. Do the complete opposite of a shrink. The problem with our culture is you can pay a shrink to tell you everything
that benefits you, to do things and to believe things that are in your own benefit, not the culture's benefit, for the most part. Mm-hmm. You need to open up a chain of psychiatric hospitals where you scream at people and tell them that personal responsibility means accepting blame for all your actions, and you need to lash out at other people and not get along. Don't accept things.
Yes. Look, I think letting God, let go and let God was a great idea before nuclear weapons. It was a great idea before human beings had the capacity to destroy their Earth.
You're writing the big new Pete Holmes movie with Judd Apatow and Will Ferrell and Adam McKay, and it's going to be on HBO.
Literally none of those people, but go on.
And Judd Apatow.
Literally none of those people.
And here's what I want
Not
you to do.
Either. No.
Here's what on. I want you to do. I want you to put this into practice. I want you to go into your next writing meeting and not give in, not be part of the fabric. I want you to clench your fist, stomp your feet, and challenge them and be difficult to work with. Can you do that for me?
Oh, David, I am light years ahead of you. you just described every day.
No.
You just described my normal M.O.
You don't
believe
do
me.
That.
I am.
You don't do
I don't.
That.
Look, no, I mean, if I have to, believe me, there have been plenty of times when I've offended people. It's happened at other jobs where I just say, hey, this is wrong. And, if you don't agree with me, okay. But I want it on the record. Oh, yeah, believe me. I mean,
really?
I'm in for roasts. You know, so, you know, as have you. I mean, a lot of people have very weird ideas about what's okay in a roast, and those ideas change. And, you know, I'm someone who says, you know, you can do a good roast without hitting certain kinds of topics. You know, and that's something a lot of people don't believe in. They think it's any kind of joke works.
Mm-hmm.
So no, I enjoy. Since I was a little kid, I've gotten too much enjoyment out of being the one person to stand and say no. I mean, I've had entire schools turn on me. I've had rooms full of people just hate me all at once, and I'm ashamed to say I kind of liked it.
You're conservative.
Better than them.
Then maybe you're conservative. You're standing athwart history and saying stop. You're a conservative.
Well, up until high school, I was.
Ah, people. Interesting.
Up until, you know, I learned stuff. I used to be just a regular patriotic American. And then I started reading Howard Zinn, and I had that same moment that every teenager has.
Dave Sirus, you'll come back? When are you back in?
Of course.
When are you back in New York?
I'll be back in July.
July.
Sometime.
July?
Mm-hmm.
Every Christian who ever met you is thinking that privately to themselves. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you, David.
I'll talk to you soon.
All right.
Joining us with his tail between his legs in Los Angeles, crawling back to me to apologize, comedian, comedy writer, Liam McEneaney. Hello there, Liam.
Hi, David. How are you? It's so great to be on your podcast.
Hey, congratulations.
It's such an honor.
Congratulations.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. For what?
for getting on the David Feldman Show.
You know what? I had a really hard time booking this podcast. I had to pick up my phone and say yes to you.
You've been invited back.
I have. I am a returning champion for the David Feldman Show. And let me tell you something. Of the 13 things I should be doing right now, this is easily my top 1 through 12 favorite.
So are you going to apologize for leaving New York City and going to Los Angeles and discovering that David Feldman was right, telling you not to move, to stay in New York, to fight it out?
Well, first of all, let me apologize to the good people of New York City for moving. I didn't realize what a blow it would be to civic pride. And, you know, I found it really touching because actually the city of New York, to kind of as a gesture to reach out to me, I understand they threw an entire civic pride parade this past weekend to, like, show how proud they are of their city and how much they miss me.
And I marched in that. You said to me, hey, David, there's a big pride to honor Liam McEneaney. It would be really great for you to put on your short shorts and a tank top and march.
Right.
And I did.
I wanted you to get a healthy tan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And, you know, I guess like this to symbolize that even though I'm gone, there's still a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow.
Mm-hmm.
I understand the city like supplied a lot of people with rainbow flags and outfits and assless chaps. And I was really very touched at how much the entire city of New York missed me.
Yeah. I you know what I noticed? How flamboyant your fans are.
Oh, when they get excited, they just can't help but dance and burst in the song.
This is Liam McEneaney, best week ever. What's the name of your big show? Tell your friends about it, or what's it called?
No, best week ever is definitely my best credit. I have done nothing in the last 11 years. So, luckily, best week ever. If there's one thing you know about Viacom shows, VH1 gave me enough money to retire on after that. So if you're listening at home, it's not a sign of laziness that David could only supply a credit from 11 years ago, a sign that he didn't research maybe. It's just really kind of where I peaked in my career.
That's not true. What's the name of your new comedy CD?
It's called Working Class Fancy from Comedy Dynamics.
Right.
You can hear it on Sirius XM. It's in pretty heavy rotation right now. I'm very proud of it. A lot of people seem to like it. I really feel like I'm making it in L.A. because I can see a Scientology building from where I'm sitting.
Are you sitting out at the cafe near UCB?
No, actually, I mean, I'm in I'm in Malibu right now in my rental. I just like things aren't going as well as I'd hoped out here. So I could only rent a home out in Malibu for the season.
Aww.
So hopefully, you know, things will turn around and I can buy something. But right now I'm in Malibu, and, you know, it's not as big as I'd hoped. And I kind of have to share a beach with Madonna and Bob Dylan.
Are you doing like an Airbnb where you live in the maid's quarters? And
no, this is, you know, Stephen Kate. Stephen Kate, Spielberg and Capshaw. Well, they got divorced a while ago. And this house was joint property, and neither of them wanted to sell because it would mean that the other one made a lot of money. So they just kind of leave it empty most of the year. And Steve, you know Steve, right? Spielberg, he offered to let me rent it from him for a reasonable price.
The whole house?
Whole house. I mean, it's not that big. You know, it's like a few bedrooms. I have a couple of friends who are going to come and stay with me over the summer. And, you know.
Oh, so you so you charge them to stay with
no,
you?
No, no, no. It's just, no, no, they're going to. You know, it's kind of like one of those deals where it's like I let, you know, Lauren and Michaels, you might know him, and Marty Short and Steve Martin. I don't know if you know those guys, but I let them stay with me. And then we'll all go out to St. Bart's for a couple of weeks and I'll stay with them. And like, you know, that kind of it's just that kind of deal, you know, it's like a friends helping each other kind of deal.
So you're kind of like a personal assistant. The comedy didn't go well. And you're kind of renting this house as a business, and you invite these people like Lauren Michaels, Steve Martin, Marty Short to stay at the house, and then you kind of make them dinner.
No.
Answer their call, right?
No, it's more like I met Lauren Michaels through Steven Spielberg. I think I told you I know him. I was writing a was helping him. I mean, I wasn't even writing it. I wish I was lead writer. I was one of the people who was helping George write the new Indiana Jones movie.
George?
It's Lucas. He's half retired, so you might not have run into him.
Oh, so hey, that's great. You're a writer's assistant for these guys. You're going to learn a lot just typing what they say into a computer. And I bet they'll take some of your ideas and trust you. You'll get to see some of your words on the screen.
You pretty much described what it's like to so-called collaborate with George and Steven. George just, you know, throws out ideas and I'm writing. And at the end of the day, Steven's just like, look, I've read your other work. I trust your gut. You can just throw that stuff away.
This is such a great lesson in business management. Guys like George Lucas and Steven Spielberg.
They're filmmakers. I don't know if you've heard of them.
Yes, I have.
And the way they direct.
And no idea should be rejected. And it doesn't matter who the idea comes from. If it's good, it should stand on its own. And somebody like you, who's been hired on as a writer's assistant, is called a collaborator. And I think that's such a great way to run your business, where everybody is kind of equal.
I'm more of a co-writer. But listen, enough about me.
No, that's great.
I heard you got nominated for an award for that puppet show you were writing for. Was that puppet show called?
I want to get back to you moving to Hollywood and making a mistake, realizing that it wasn't going to work out. And then when it didn't work out, and you realize you weren't going to make it, that David Feldman was correct, you made lemonade. You did a gut check. You looked in the mirror and said, okay, I'm not an actor. I'm not a writer.
Right.
I have things to learn. I'll go get it.
I will be acting in the new Indiana Jones movie, but generally I'm not an actor.
See,
I'm only going to be like third or fourth billed. So, yeah, I mean, it's like not really that big of a deal.
It's like you're going to school. That's what Steve and Spielberg and George Lucas do. They take somebody like you, a production assistant, a writer's assistant like you.
Writer, yes.
And they say, you know what? We want you to learn everything. We're going to give you a job as an extra in this movie as well. So you're like in the background scene, right? What do you
play? Well, I'm in the background of a lot of scenes, but I'm mostly a co-lead, I think is the term.
This is so great. It's so egalitarian that they would call an extra a co-lead. That's fantastic.
Right.
These are the Hollywood values that we have to bring to the rest of the country. These progressive...
You know Harrison, right? Whenever he's on screen, nobody's looking at me. I get what you're saying. My job is mostly to react to whatever he's doing. So you're right. You know, like I'm definitely like, not the lead, but I would say, co-star maybe. Or other star, or star after the star, maybe.
You know, I've always wanted to start a comedy think tank with this podcast, and that's exactly how I would run it. Everybody's a co-star. Everybody is a writer.
Because I think a lot of people feel like your podcast is a lot like community theater, you know, like comedy community theater, like a charity gig almost, you know? Like everyone comes in and pitches in equally.
My concern for you, and I'm glad things are going well, and I think it's really great that
things aren't. I don't want you to feel like things aren't going. I mean, okay, so you know how they're already prepping the new Transformers movie.
Uh huh.
Right. So, I was kind of asked to write the first few drafts of that, and then but the thing is, because the last Transformers movie didn't do so well. Like, usually you get $500,750 for this kind of work, but now they're saying, like, oh, well, we'll pay you $250,000 and then we'll give you a bump every $50 million that the picture grosses at the box office internationally. So it's like, yes, that could I could technically walk away with $1 million, but will I be making as much money as I should right off the bat? Not really. So, I mean, just I don't want you to feel like things are going that well for me.
So that's what the guy writing the Transformer movie said to you to justify why he's paying you so little to be his assistant?
Well, producing the Transformer movie, who hired me to write, when I had a conversation with Michael Bay about it, yes.
You met Michael Bay?
Well, some would say Michael Bay met me, but yes, I would say we met each other for dinner.
You met him through the writer you're working for? The writer?
He heard some of my comedy on the radio, and then he asked for some writing samples, and then he asked to meet me.
Did you feel insulted that he asked for writing samples? That's got to be. I hope you put the writing samples together and you swallowed your pride, because you never know, Liam, when one of these jobs can turn into something more than just being an assistant.
Right. I absolutely agree. I mean, like, part of my deal, because I'm getting paid so little, is the studio has to finance the script that I sent them as a sample. You know, they really liked it, and at first they were like, no, but then the whole pay thing came up. So I'm going to write and direct it and star in it, like kind of do the Woody Allen thing. Well, it's not going to be a big budget deal.
Hold on to that dream, my friend, because you're meeting the right people, and eventually this can come to fruition.
Well, I mean, we'll see. You know, it's just like, it kind of stinks, because if this film thing goes through, then I'm going to have to put my sitcom on the back burner. And that was just kind of what I came to L.A. to do, you know?
Are you spreading yourself too thin, being a writer's assistant to Michael Bay's new writer, and then being a writer's assistant to George Lucas and Steven Spielberg? I mean, being a writer's assistant takes up a lot of time. I'm worried that you're burning the candle both ends.
I was also worried about that. And then I read this book. It's kind of my how-to manual on surviving in Hollywood. It's called The Kid Stays in the Picture.
Robert Evans.
Oh, you've heard of it. You know Robert? I met him, you know, whatever. He seemed a nice enough guy. But in the book, they talk about this creative aid that they use called cocaine. And, you know, I hadn't heard of this cocaine before, but apparently it adds about 7 to 8 hours to your working day.
How can you afford cocaine on a writer's assistant salary? I mean, what do they pay?
If I could get one of my assistants fired and take their salary, then I wouldn't have to go out of pocket for this cocaine.
Wait a second.
That's a really good idea.
This is so wasteful in Hollywood. And it's generous, I have to admit. Writer's assistants have their own assistants.
I don't know if my assistants have their own assistants. If they do, then I could definitely see how I could maybe get some more money for this cocaine, because I have to tell you something. I'm really enjoying the cocaine even more than the writing and the directing and the producing.
But cocaine is very expensive. I just don't see where you have the money to buy something like that.
You know what? You caught me. And I guess I wasn't going to talk about this, because I'm only kind of talking about the glamour gigs. But I will be headlining a few arenas across the country over the next year. Like, you know, Madison Square Garden and O2 in London. And, you know, just like a few, like, select bigger arenas. I'm going to have Louis C.K. opening for me kind of deal. So that's pretty much where my coke money is going to come from.
I don't understand.
I like coke a lot. And it's, as you said, it's very expensive.
The other stuff. The arena?
I haven't touched the other stuff. I'd be afraid to try anything, you know, harder than cocaine.
No. I'm talking about...
I understand cocaine can be a gateway drug. Mushrooms and acid.
No. I'm talking about you headlining Madison Square Garden?
Right. Madison Square... It's not a real garden. It's like a big arena where normally sports teams play.
Yeah, I get that.
I'm not doing like a garden, not in back of someone's house. It's like a real arena. Used to be in a place called Madison Square.
I get all that. I know about Madison Square Garden. What I don't get is you're headlining Madison Square Garden. I'm looking this up on the internet as we speak, and I do see Liam McEneaney, 3 nights at Madison Square Garden, August 5th.
Correct.
6th and 7th. Louis C.K. and Todd Barry are the opening acts.
Todd got on the show. Okay, that's good.
What's that about? I feel like you kind of misled me here.
Well, no. I just didn't know Todd was also on the show. I would have told you.
No, I just feel like you entered into this interview on false pretenses.
Well, I mean, you know, it's like I've only been in L.A. for 9 months. I haven't had that much time to accomplish anything. But let's talk about you. How'd your show at QED go last night?
So wait a second. So you're headlining Madison Square Garden.
I'm closing it out.
It says here, star of the new HBO series, Liam.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know we were announcing that. Yeah. You know, it's like I didn't really want to do it, but then I did Judd's show at large. You know Judd Apatow? You met Judd? David? Hello?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Have you met Judd?
Yeah.
Yeah, you met Judd Apatow?
Yeah.
All right, so I did Judd's show at Largo. And are you not crying, are you? It sounds like you're crying a little bit.
No, if it does, it would be because I'd be happy for you.
Oh, fantastic. Then, yeah. You know, cause I wasn't going to bring it up because, you know, like, I feel like some of my less accomplished friends, you know, get a little bummed out when I talk about how great.
Do you think that I would be jealous of you for all this? That I wouldn't be happy?
No. No, of course. I mean, you've got your memories of The Daily Show, and that's great, too.
No, I mean, you didn't. I'm just concerned that you started this interview and you kept certain information from me about your career. And I'm worried that you thought that I would resent your success because you think I don't have enough success in my own career. So you were just kind of trying to fit in by not telling me about Liam on HBO.
Well, here's the thing. I had a long conversation with Alex Brazell. You know him? He runs Showbiz Studios.
I haven't spoken to him. Have you spoken? He doesn't. I haven't spoken to him in a couple of weeks.
Oh, yeah. He's always calling me, just pitching his clients for different shows and jobs and stuff like that.
I introduced you to Alex.
Right.
I think it's great that Alex and you have a relationship because that's what this business is all about. It's giving wings to youth and letting them fly. That's what it's all about. So you spoke to Alex, huh?
I spoke to Alex Brazell. He's telling me, like, I should hire Matt Goldich because he's a great writer. And he's like, you know, who else is a great writer is Kevin Bartini. Mm-hmm. Who has a podcast on my network. And
good. It's always, that's good. Because when they succeed, we all succeed. Yeah, good. Great.
Yeah, and he was like, you should hire my friend I went to college with who's never written for anything before, but, you know, he would probably be good in a writer's room. And I was like, sure, I'll take a chance on that kid. Why not, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the guy at the deli across the street had a couple funny jokes, and maybe he could write for your roast set next month.
You're doing a roast?
Well, Comedy Central's doing their roast. So Mike Myers. You know Mike Myers from Austin Powers and Love Guru.
I didn't know that they were doing a roast.
Yeah, Mike asked me to do it as a favor. I can't say no to Mike.
Alex, who's my producer and my manager, he probably...
Oh, he's your manager? Oh, that's interesting. Oh. Huh. That's interesting because your name didn't really, all right. Well, okay, great. Sure. Yeah.
Yeah,
so
my name didn't, he knows that I'm being very selective about my writing work.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He said something about that.
Yeah.
He said you really wanted to focus on your puppet show and your podcast. By the way, congratulations. Cable Ace Award?
Yeah.
I don't know. One of those things.
So how long did you know about Liam being on HBO? How long did Alex know about this? I'm just kind of curious.
Oh, it's just one of those things where, you know, I was at a party.
Did Alex make the deal?
Well, he's the one who introduced me to Lena. You know, Dunham?
Yeah.
She had a show on HBO for a little bit. I guess he and her are good friends, and he's gotten a couple of people staffed on that show over the last couple of years before it went off the air. So we went to the finale party, and I start talking to some people, and, you know, they were just like, oh, you know what? We've never seen your stand-up or read a word you've written, but you're such an interesting person, you should just have a TV show. Anyways, I mean,
I told you not to move to Los Angeles because it's quicksand.
Dude, you're stuck there.
You're stuck there now. You're stuck.
I mean, like, I could have been in New York City doing shows at QED.
Now you're trapped.
You know, living in a rent stabilized apartment in Central Queens, like I was.
Now you're trapped in this endless cycle of movies and sitcoms and on the road. I told you not.
And it's like, you can't really have a relationship, like a strict relationship with a woman, you know, like it's like that kind of fulfilling relationship that you want. So I'm just like dating these two women and, you know, which is kind of,
yeah.
You know,
so did Alex,
it's expensive to date two women.
Did Alex say anything about my possibly doing a guest set at Madison Square Garden in between Todd Barry and Louis C.K.?
I love you, David. You're like the best. Like, I'm like this guy who became famous, and then you're like the rag picker that I fondly remember, you know, like giving scraps of food to. Like, I feel like that's the kind of relationship we have. Right?
I love it when
I
love it when you make fun of me because I know you don't mean it.
I'll tell you what, David, I am offering 5 minutes at my secret QED show. I'm doing a secret show at QED midnight on around the time that I'm doing Madison Square Garden. That's all I can say legally. And I'm offering stage time to anyone who can hook me up with cocaine in New York City. You know, as fun as the Madison Square Garden gig is, this is the cocaine that I'm really like, it's really kind of become my overriding interest.
The show for HBO, Liam?
Yes, with an exclamation point.
Where are they making it?
Well, we're going to film it in New York City.
At Buttercup over in Queens?
Yes, Buttercup Studios.
Oh, man.
And also, we're just going to be filming all over the city.
I'm living in Manhattan, and the idea of having to get up and go take a writing job and schlep all the way out to Buttercup Studios in Queens.
I wouldn't do that to you. I would never do that to you.
Yeah.
You know, when you get older, you need your rest. I get that.
Yeah.
You know what's cool is there is actually a character in the show. He's kind of an older show business mentor figure, like a writer. He's Jewish. His name is David.
Yeah.
David Leibowitz.
Close.
You know, kind of like won a lot of Cable Ace Awards in his day.
Hmm. So you need an actor.
No. Lewis Black's going to play that role. But I just wanted to let you know that that's kind of one of the characters that's going to be on the show. So HBO's legal team kind of wanted me to tell you that if you try to sue them, they're going to destroy you. So I hate to be, don't kill the messenger.
Lewis lives in Manhattan.
Yeah. Well, you know, when they found out I got Lewis Black, they were like, yeah, we'll get car service for him. Like, he doesn't have to wake up a minute earlier than he needs to. We're kind of working around his schedule a little bit.
Yeah, but
because older folks get, you get a little bit tired and, so I wouldn't want to do that to him to make him feel obligated.
Hope he's doing okay, that he needs a gig like that to have to.
Yeah, he's going to be making a lot of money next year because we're co-headlining across Europe.
Wow. Seems like a shame to have to work that hard at his age. You know, it's
two hours a night. Plus, he and I are going to be actually, because, you know,
I like to sleep in my own bed. You know, I have my creature.
So he's actually going to co-author half of the scripts for this show.
A lot of writing to do to pay the bills. I hope his business.
I mean, we actually
steal his money.
It's so funny.
It sounds desperate. Lewis Black. It sounds like he's desperate. don't know.
Well, I guess it's just they're doing something called preemptively nominating us for an Emmy, just based on both of our track records.
Sounds so, like you're just chasing gold and mammon at the expense of your spiritual growth. It just seems like an empty,
I agree with you.
Empty experience.
I wish I could be back in New York City doing QED shows again. Oh, God. I mean, like, that's because then you're doing it for yourself, you know? I mean, literally, there's three people in the audience.
So, Alex...
You're literally doing it for yourself.
Alex, you spoke to Alex, huh?
Yeah, he's the one who hooked me up with Lewis.
It's interesting because 5 years ago, I introduced Alex was 18 at the time, 5 years ago, and I introduced him to Lewis Black, which is... He never would have met Lewis Black had it not been for me. It's kind of interesting that...
Cats in the cradle, man. Yeah. Cats in the cradle. What can I tell you?
Well...
But you know, the great thing is, because I handed Alex the script, the pilot script. He said Lewis would be great, not only for the role of David. We both agree that was our first choice. But also he said, like, what you need is someone who's an experienced writer. You know, he studied playwriting at Yale. And he said, like, you need someone who's, like, really good at writing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, really, really good at comedy. Because we were talking about you initially.
Really?
But then we both agreed, like, yeah, but then we both agreed, like, that would make you feel bad. Like, if your scripts weren't up to par or, you know, like, if you, you know, like, if they weren't any good or you didn't know what you were doing or, you know, like, you freaked out halfway through the process and quit or... You know, like if you kind of just had a meltdown and cried a lot at the writer's table or, you know, like you just kind of embarrassed yourself or, you know, peed yourself at a party or, you know, didn't know who anyone was and kind of insulted everybody in the room or, you know, just kind of like got into a big flame war with someone on Twitter or, you know, any of these things that could possibly happen to you. We felt it wouldn't be fair to you to put you in the spotlight like that. Like in the firing line.
Thank you for that. And I'm being very selective.
You know, also, it's just kind of like, you know,
wow.
We agreed, like, you're so comfortable in that SRO you live in. You have your bathroom down the hall.
Well, I thought it,
you have your kitchenette.
When Alex said he would get me SRO, I thought he meant standing room only, like I was going to sell out a club.
No, he would never let you sell out.
Yeah,
staying true to your principles, man.
Right. The only reason I'm in an SRO is I thought it meant standing room only. And I
right.
So I, not that I need to stay at this.
Right.
But it.
Right. No, I understand you can't afford furniture for it. So technically an SRO, you know, standing room only.
So.
Is what I heard, but I would never.
Hey, so no. I don't know if Alex told you about my theory about back to zero. Have I ever told you my back to zero theory about comedy?
No.
I feel like guys like me who get really successful. Well, obviously, you know what success is like.
I'm just stepping up the rungs of the ladder. I'm not ready. Look, just because of Variety or, you know, the New York Times would call me a huge success. I don't agree with that.
Yeah.
I mean, success is just that anyone who's above ground breathing in the, during the day.
Right. So you're new to the success game.
Right.
I've been around the block and I've been successful for a long time.
You have been around successful people, right?
I've been successful for a long time and I stay successful doing this back to zero thing where I do a reset.
Is that like a weight loss?
No, it's I do a reset to keep my comedic chops sharp. One of the things I like to do is swim around in the muck with the new guys. And it's not about the money, believe me. It's not about the money.
Right.
I like to.
I hope not.
Yeah, I'll occasionally staff up and take a job.
Right.
Just to mix it up.
Very occasional.
I'll mix it up with the young kids because they keep me sharp. They keep me honest. I kind of do it on the DL. You know what DL means?
Yes, it means you're secretly gay.
And maybe I was misled. What I meant is I don't make a big thing out of it. I go in there. I hang out in the writing room. I work really hard.
Right.
I show up on time as though like I'm just like a kid starting out. I don't make trouble. I keep my mouth shut. I'm very supportive. of everybody right. in the room. You know, I don't create camps. You don't have to worry.
You're definitely known for showing up early and leaving late and asking if there are food or drink tickets. Those are the things you are known for.
My back to zero program, where I just shed all my accomplishments and I'm just a raw nerve starting out again. Get that hunger again. Get that hunger, because that's what makes a man funny. My back to zero program, occasionally I will staff up. I'll go Writers Guild minimum, you know? I'll do the minimum. I'll keep my mouth shut. I'll work really hard. I won't make trouble. I don't hang out.
Minimum wage job. I got it.
Writers Guild, you know, union job. I don't hang out at craft services, bad-mouthing the star and the executive producer. Really, back to zero is about learning to be a team player, getting out of myself and being part of the larger fabric. That's what I like to do. The same way George Clooney or Brad Pitt will take a supporting role in an independent film to help a new director, young actor starting out. So are
I mean, George has been really supportive of Liam. You're right. He's taking SAG minimum to have a co-starring role in my show. So I totally hear what you're saying.
Yeah.
And that is, you know, and that's why I would never insult you by offering you any kind of paying gig whatsoever.
Well, I think Writers Guild minimum.
In any form.
I think,
you know,
one of the I think both of us have gotten to a point in our career where obviously Writers Guild minimum is slavery and it's insulting, but that's not why I'm going to do this for you. I'm doing it really for myself, Liam.
No, I mean, I understand. I mean, I hear what you're saying. I agree. I would never hire you.
Right.
Like, I was thinking about it, like, as kind of like one of those, like, hey, you know, whatever happened to, like, I was at NBC and I was talking to some people there and, you know, just kind of like, oh, what's David Feldman up to? And I told them that I was going to do your podcast and they were like, oh, yeah, David Feldman, that's a blast from the past, from the distant past, like, you know, like a dinosaur times kind of deal. You know how industry jokes around like that.
Mm-hmm.
And we agreed, you know, that like that what you're doing at QED really is important, too.
Right.
It's important that there's guys like you with a lot of street cred.
And
or sometimes even living on the street cred.
Yeah. And one of the. You know, one of the ways I keep my street cred is by going to work every day.
Right.
This back to zero thing.
Right.
No more than
zero vision. Right.
Zero. And it's just all about serving others.
Right.
I think you would, if I decide to
like
do
a waiter.
This, if I decide.
Like a caterer.
Yeah. You know, should I deign to go back to zero on Liam? Exclamation point.
Right.
You would learn what? Humility from me. Humility is more than just spiritual. It's just good for business. I think my humility will go a long way.
Right. What profits a man who gains the world if he loses his soul? Right. I know exactly what you're talking about.
My back to zero thing to keep me funny. Being funny is a lot about humility.
A lot of working with Chris Gersbeck and, you know, Freddie Goldstein and kind of learning from them a little bit.
Yeah, well,
learning the basics of joke writing from them, and
I really need humility. Do you understand what I'm saying? I have gotten to a point where I've been so successful and things have been going so well. I'm kind of begging you. I know this sounds insane. I'm kind of begging you to let me be humble before you and God.
Right.
You understand what I'm. You understand what I'm saying, that I would be...
The guild minimum.
I'm a big union guy. You know that, right?
Right. Definitely. All my shows are union.
Yeah. And here's the thing, because I'm big with the union, all for one, one for all, the unity.
Right.
We're all in this together. As a...
Right. We can do it, like Rosie the Riveter.
Right. So my thing is, and I'm only saying this because I'm going back to zero. This is about my humility and my support for the Writers Guild. In order for me to understand how important the union is, I think it might be a good idea for you to pay me a little less than Writers Guild. Maybe off the books.
Maybe.
Oh.
So
I
that,
can't do that.
Well, I know you can't do that, and it really makes me sick to even suggest this. However, I think I'd be doing my fellow union members, the rank and file, I'd be doing them a favor, because then I could speak from experience on what it's like to take a non-union job, because I think I've forgotten it.
Here's my thoughts about that, is I just learned that I'm going to have to fire my writer's assistants and some of their assistants to pay for this cocaine. I'm not sure. I mean, like, if I'm getting rid of assistants, I didn't even know these writer's assistants had assistants. I'm freeing up this budget for cocaine.
Right.
And, you know, I got to be honest, like, there's just not going to be really, once I'm done slashing the budget, any room for anyone other than me and Lewis, Alex's friends from the deli, Chris Gersbeck, yeah. I got him a job, and Micah Fox, and Karen Feehan, and gosh, who else is on? Jim Earle, and Barry Lank, and, yeah. you know, Tony Kameen, and, oh yeah, Aaron Sorkin.
Okay.
He's got a big fee.
All right.
And, so, you know, and then they all have to have their assistants, and so I'm looking in the budget for the assistants. Maybe if I could trim a few of those guys and maybe get a wholesale deal on my cocaine, I could afford to pay you $150. And is $150, I mean, that's a lot, right?
$150 what?
You know,
$150 what?
$150K. $150,000? No, K is my shorthand for a week.
$150 a week?
$150 a week, yeah. It's a little below WJ minimum. In fact, it's so far below WJ minimum, technically, you would be billed in the credits, not at all.
That's a lot of humility.
You know, I would offer to pay you more, but you gave me this whole rap about how you want to start over.
I don't need to get that spiritual. How about something a little less enlightened?
Okay, I mean, I could give you $100 a week.
That's too purifying for me. That's way
too
much.
You mean you want like a yoga mat?
No, I'm saying is $100, $150 a week is too much. More
too much? I got that.
No,
okay, so $50 a week.
No.
I'll tell you $50 a week, and you can have whatever's left over from craft services at the end of the shoot.
My ego would just evaporate, and while that's something that we all strive for, I really think I would get the bends from that. What was
that's
the
great.
You said 150? I think that's probably in the range of spirituality that I can.
I really like that a lot.
In yes, so I start when
I like that a lot.
When do I?
Oh no, I thought you were talking about the bends, the Radiohead album. Well, you could, I guess. At $125 a week.
Oh, that's a little. I thought
we would have to
I'm just
candy budget.
Hang on for one second. I really think 150 is like
115. Got it.
No, 150.
So at 115 a week.
No, 150. I'm not doing
right.
I mean, it's insane that we're talking about money because this is all about
right.
my spiritual well-being. But I think 100.
And it's so awkward to talk about it with a good friend.
Yeah, so 150.
You know, 115, got it.
$150.
Agreed, 115.
$150 a week.
115 every other week, got it. Biweekly.
How about 115 a week?
115 bimonthly, got it. You're just negotiating against yourself now, pal.
Okay.
I'm trying to bring you up to 115 a week.
How about 115 every other week? Look, I'll be honest with you. Normally I wouldn't make this deal, but
right.
really starving for spirituality and enlightenment.
Right. Okay. Well, I'll tell you what.
Yeah.
You know, I told my 10-year-old nephew he could have a job. And we were going to use that money to pay him because he kind of had a really good idea for character arc for the last 3 episodes. Kind of one of the most intelligent things that would ever be aired on HBO. But, you know, okay. I'll just tell him that he's going to have to take an executive producer credit, you know, like it.
What am I getting?
You are getting 100 every other week. And if the WGA asks, I've never heard of you. And also, we might have to stuff you in a car trunk for 8 hours if they come do an on-set visit.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I mean that.
Well, listen, man, I just don't want you to think. I like to think of myself as one of the few guys in Hollywood who remembers his friends.
Thank you.
And is grateful to everyone who gave him a leg up. There's a lot of people in this town that wouldn't give you that kind of deal.
Well, thank you. Everybody, when they see David Feldman, it's like, pull out the red carpet. Let's all be successful
right.
And brag to David.
Yes, give him your secondhand carpet so he has something to sleep on.
It feels so good to be given an opportunity to just re-experiencing my birth again in show business. And I thank you for that. I thank you for the opportunity to be humble. Hey, congratulations.
Oh, thank you. For what?
For getting on the David Feldman Show. That's our show. Please check out Jerry's House and give to that. Also give to St. Jude's Hospital. Rick Overton's series, I'm Dying Up Here, Sunday nights on Showtime from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. Medicare for all.